players to the third member of our team, who moments ago met up with Mac Brown. Here's Christina Pink.
Mac, the one constant on Thanksgiving in college football is the Texas Longhorns. What does this tradition mean to you?
It's really special to us because everybody that's watching college football tonight is watching the Texas Longhorns. So it's a chance for us to showcase who we are and let everybody out there see about Longhorn football.
We are 6-1 in conference, so still in contention in the Big 12. How do you need your players to respond these last two games?
What I've told the guys, there's a process, and the reason you won 6 in a row in the league, you got to go back and continue to do that process tonight. Win this game, and the rest of it takes care of itself. And we can tell everybody out there, happy Thanksgiving.
All right, thanks, Coach.
All right, Christina, Texas is playing its 86th Thanksgiving Day game. The Longhorns are 58-24-3. In previous Thanksgiving games, the first one was played in 1893, an 18-16 win over Dallas University. Texas A&M has been the opponent 69 times. Perfect weather for college football in Austin, 50 degrees at kickoff time. Texas Tech won the toss. They will receive the ball. Cliff Kingsbury in his first year, his team started 7-0. They've lost four straight, looking to bounce back. Mac Brown, longtime Texas coach, has been under fire this season. However, he still has a 6-1 conference record, and with some help from Oklahoma, if they win out, they could share the Big 12 title. Texas Tech, and we're underway from Austin. And the Red Raiders will start from the goal line. As they advance, this is Reginald Davis. And Davis, a flag on the play, gets close to the 35. Well, let's see what the call is on the field. Greg Burks, your referee this evening.
During the return, holding number 22, the return team, 10 yards to the spot of the foul, first down.
So let's take a look at our high-performance players.
Jason Morrow has been playing the best tight end in the country. Mackey Award members, take note. LaRaven Clark has his hands full tonight. Whether it's Jackson Jeffcoat or Cedric Reed pass rushing. Jackson Jeffcoat, Cedric Reed, one of the best pass rushing duos in the country.
First down and 10 at the 16-yard line for the Red Raiders. Baker Mayfield, the freshman from Austin, Texas. Lake Travis High School in the shotgun. He'll throw on first down underneath, and it's caught at the 26-yard line. Bradley Marquez, and he picks up a first down. Quandre Diggs with the tackle as you take a look at the freshman, Baker Mayfield.
Kid plays with a lot of moxie. Does not mind a challenge at all.
On the play action fake, Mayfield, he'll just ground this one. Texas, great anticipation. Jackson Jeffcoat with pressure.
And be ready tonight for Texas Tech to have a few changes in their lineup. Don't be surprised if you see Bradley Marquez, who made the first catch of the night, number 4. Normally an outside receiver, going to the slot a lot more tonight. I think that is actually a good move for him. With his size and his quickness, I think the slot's a perfect place for him.
Second down and 10, and he'll swing it out. This is Dale Foster. Foster looking for running room. And Foster gobbled up and taken down after a 6-yard gain.
I think this is the kind of night where Cliff Kingsbury lets it all out there. I don't think he does anything about saving plays in the playbook. This evening, look for a lot of exotic things from Texas Tech, and they're going to press it, trying to break this 4-game losing streak.
So on third down and 4, the 33, empty backfield for the Red Raiders. Mayfield, that ball batted down at the line of scrimmage, and Texas Tech will have to punt it away. Looks like Quandre Diggs may have gotten a hand on the football.
Moving into the nickel position, watch him at the top of your screen. They don't get a chance to block him and put him on the ground and create a throwing lane. See, when a guy's in the face of the quarterback like that, LaRaven Clark, unable to get any hands on him and knock him to the ground or to the side to create a throwing lane for Baker Mayfield.
Ryan Erksleben will punt it from the 19-yard line. Jackson Shipley, the junior, back deep at his own 22. And Shipley takes a peek and he'll get a shot. Shipley with a lane, and he advances over the 25-yard line up to the 26 as Michael Alway comes up with the tackle on special teams. And here are our high-performance players.
Expect Texas to run it a lot tonight. Malcolm Brown is the feature back with the injury to Jonathan Gray. Mike Davis is their big target downfield, averages 34 yards on his touchdown catches this season. Kerry Hyder is a native of Austin, Texas, wants to go out big. He'll play all along the defensive line. And Will Smith, 16 tackles in their last game against Baylor.
So first down and 10 of the 27, opening drive for Texas. Case McCoy, the starting quarterback. Malcolm Brown, the pistol back. They give it to him on first down. And Brown, over the line of scrimmage, will pick up 2.5. As for Case McCoy, this is his 14th start, 10th in career passing yards with close to 3,500. Second down and 7 at the 30. Here's Malcolm Brown again, running right this time. And they want to run the football. We talked to the Texas offensive side of the ball. There was no secret about what they want to do.
Yeah, Major Applewhite, their offensive coordinator, that's all he talked about was he thinks that it can be a game of attrition, that if they can keep running the football, keep it steady, keep pounding. And so if you get Major Applewhite, what he wants to do is run the football all the game long and hope the benefits show up third quarter, fourth quarter, as they break Texas Tech.
Texas Tech has had major problems against the run this year. Third and 5. McCoy under pressure. McCoy on the run and incomplete. Ball intended for Marcus Johnson. Pete Robertson with backside pressure. And Texas forced a punt, 3 and out.
And a team that's been fragile defensively for the last month of the season. Texas Tech does a world of good for your confidence when you can get off the field quickly against Texas.
So Anthony Farrah, who is the punter and place kicker, punts from the 17-yard line. Back deep, Jordan Davis for Texas Tech. Wobbly kick. Davis comes up to field it. Doesn't signal for a fair catch and is dropped immediately. A 39-yard punt. Adrian Corbett with the tackle on special teams. So coming up,
Cliff Kingsbury, you let it all go tonight from your playbook. For Texas, run it Bevo style. Doesn't matter what the down and distance, don't be surprised if Texas keeps the ball on the ground and tries to pound away at the Texas Tech defense, which has struggled against the run.
First down and 10 of the 29, second series for the Red Raiders. Mayfield, he'll swing it out to Marquez, and Marquez gets up to the 35-yard line before being pushed out of bounds by Carrington Bynum. Now, Texas Tech lost to Baylor 63-34 at Arlington in their last game, and the Red Raiders gave up more than 277 yards rushing for the fourth straight game as they hand the ball off. Washington once again.
And they certainly did. That total ended up being 340 yards Baylor put on them running the football. And it you're talking about 600 yards total offense for the night. So Cliff Kingsbury went in his 12 days and really tried to shore up the defense. But offensively, look for him tonight. Open things up. Turn it loose with Baker Mayfield at the controls.
Tech led 14-0 and 20-7 at one point in the game. Mayfield, backside pressure, he'll run it. Mayfield picks up the first down and more, gets to midfield and tiptoes out of bounds inside Texas territory. That's a 19-yard gain on 3rd and 2.
Now watch to the top of your screen because Baker Mayfield sees that the backside is open, that the flank wasn't covered. Reggie Wilson, number 92, the defensive end, did not stay outside to force Mayfield back inside. And Mayfield knew that when he was deep in the pocket, was able to escape to his left and pick up big yardage.
Mayfield has started 6 games, the first 5, and
Texas.
Game before against Baylor, and a timeout called by Texas. And we'll take a break. 11:39 to play in the first quarter.
Both over 2,000 yards throwing up to about 2 quarterbacks in this country. This year, over 2,000 yards, both true freshmen for Texas Tech, Mayfield and Davis Webb.
First down and 10, Mayfield, he'll dump it off to DeAndre Washington. Washington trying to cut back to pick up the first down, but Michael Thompson, the junior from San Antonio, denies him the first down.
And look how fast they want to play there, Gus. You know, they're picking up nice yardage, they're in a good rhythm. That means they want to play with better tempo and pace.
And a flag on the play, this will go against the Red Raiders.
And you can't hurt yourself that way.
Number 71 offense, 5-yard penalty, second down.
You're playing so well. You're moving the ball. Everyone's moving in coordination. and syncopation. And then you get a penalty like that and slows your offense down. Those are the types of things that have hurt Cliff Kingsbury and his team all year long.
So that makes it second down and 6 yards to go at the Texas 40-yard line. Washington, the lone setback with Baker Mayfield. Here's Mayfield. Wants to run it. Bottled up and taken down. First man to him, Cedric Reed, the junior from Cleveland, Texas.
And Texas self-scouted from last week because last game, Clint Schell from Oklahoma State hurt them running the football. Able to escape, but what they did now, as you noted, Cedric Reed crashing from the end, ran him right into the defensive tackles, who stayed home and maintained position and took away the quarterback's running lanes.
Brings up third down and 8 at the 42. Mayfield. Oh, and he sacked out of nowhere. Duke Thomas from his quarterback position rushing the passer, and he drops him for a loss.
Watch coming from the bottom of the screen, coming at you is going to be Duke Thomas coming from the cornerback position. And Baker Mayfield never saw him. All of his attention was to the left side of the field, and from the backside, Thomas gets him and puts him down.
So Erksleben in the punt from the 35. High snap, handled, and he'll fake it. He's got a lane. Erksleben, first down, Texas Tech. Oh, he's still going. The punter, touchdown, Texas Tech, 51 yards. And I don't know, Charles, that didn't look like a design play.
I don't think this was a design fake. I think they were going downfield, but what happened was he bobbled the snap, and then when the guy who came in to force the punt got to him, he kept it, got to the corner, and with no pressure there, he runs into the end zone. Ryan Erksleben, in the same stadium where his father was an All-American kicker and punter, runs into the end zone for the first points of the night.
After the touchdown, unsportsmanlike conduct, number 22 of Texas Tech. That 15-yard penalty being forced on the kickoff.
Well, they got a motion going tonight if you're Texas Tech. Jason Morrow, the All-American tight end, ends up getting the penalty.
So Ryan Erksleben, who serves as not only the punter but the holder, with a 51-yard touchdown run on a fake punt. Ryan Buston in to attempt the extra point, and it's good. And the Red Raiders strike first, 9:44 to play in the first quarter. Texas Tech throwing caution.
Take a look at the fake punt now, which really wasn't a fake. It wasn't designed that way. It was supposed to be a regular punt. Look at everyone releasing, but he got forced it right there. You see, they're looking back. You know why? They haven't heard the thud off of the foot, but Erksleben was forced outside after a bad snap, had to jump and get it, and then everyone turned into a blocker. And look at Cliff Kingsbury. Look at him. He's going to ask Trey Haverty now, the special teams coach, was that a fake? Was that called? See, Haverty, hands up. I don't know what he was doing, coach, or he should have said exactly how I drew it up.
I don't know if he'd fake a punt on fourth and 17. 15-yard penalty forces Texas Tech to kick it off from the 20. This one picked up by Marcus Johnson. And Johnson gets up to the 30-yard line before being chopped down.
And if he had let it go, it probably would have gone out of bounds, and they would have got a better, even better field position.
John White with the tackle on special teams. So now Texas down 7-0, 9:38 to go here in the first quarter, as Case McCoy prepares to come back onto the field from his own 31.
Great momentum play for Texas Tech. Good way to get up 7-0. Should not alter anything Texas has in their game plan. Offensive line, they want to put the game on their shoulders. Time for them to start trying to take control.
Second series for Texas. First was 3-and-out. Malcolm Brown, and he's detained in the backfield and will be tackled for a loss. Will Smith, first man to him.
Totally unblocked on that play, Will Smith. Everyone else seemed to be occupied. He sifted through and was right there. Watch him just present himself in this play. No one blocks him at all, and he makes the tackle in the open field.
During the extra time for Texas Tech. They really worked on open field tackling. They've had some problems over the last few games, and here's Marcus Johnson. And Johnson won't get back to the line of scrimmage. Push there to make the stop.
But the man who really made the play was number 10, Pete Robertson, who plays the bandit position. Forced the play back inside and right into the waiting arms of a tackler. 46 three and outs this season, 10th most in the NCAA for them. In Division I football, they'd sure love to get another one now.
Third down and 15 at the 26. McCoy steps up to the sideline. And that ball bobbled and caught by Mike Davis, but not enough for a first down to be a little short. Bruce Jones with the tackle. And the Texas fans want him to go for it.
And they're thinking about, because they have not rushed the punt team onto the field automatically. They're thinking about lining up and going big right here. Actually, did they move it and give them a first down?
Yes, they did.
So they gave him a good spot on the play, but they gave him the length of the pass before he was brought back by Bruce Jones. So they don't even have to worry about fourth down now.
First down, high snap handled by McCoy. Malcolm Brown running right with Brew. And Brown picks up six on the play. Trey Porter with the tackle.
Really good block at the point of attack by number 82, Jeff Swaim, the junior college tight end, who does a tremendous job of blocking.
Texas to the line of scrimmage quickly. Malcolm Brown again. And Malcolm Brown picks up another first down for Texas.
Gus, that was the same play, just back to the other side. And right now, Major Applewhite, looking at his play sheet, I think he's thinking to himself, he may have something going both ways. Good momentum, let the offensive line work.
First down at the 47. And Brown, he'll stumble forward and pick up a couple. You know, Malcolm Brown is averaging over 90 yards rushing a game over his last five outings. Sam Guab brings him down.
He's become the workhorse with the injury to Jonathan Gray and the lack of trust with Joe Bergeron in terms of taking care of the football. He's had some key fumbles, as Bergeron, and he's lost carries as a result. Malcolm Brown is taking on the bulk of the work.
Second down and 8. Brown again running left. Flag on the play. Big opening. First down if it stands. Trey Porter stops it.
Personal foul. Hands to the face. Number 91 defense. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down.
That's Kerry Hyder, the senior from Austin.
He's been playing inside. There he is, number 91, and he gets the hands right up into the grill of Dominic Espinoza, the center. So tack on extra yardage after the good run by Malcolm Brown. Texas starting to put it together offensively with the offensive line starting to move it. And Jeff Swaim, number 82, the tight end, a big part of what they're doing running the football.
First down and 10 at the 20. Out of the offset eye, Malcolm Brown, the deep back. They hand it to him straight ahead, and he's met in the backfield by Will Smith.
You noted just a couple plays ago, Gus, about Texas Tech getting back to fundamentals during the time off. The extra tackling, that's Matt Wallerstedt, their defensive coordinator, who played linebacker at Kansas State and played it with a fury. You think he's had fun watching his team get shredded on defense and running the football? They've worked awfully hard at shoring up the run defense in their 12 days since their last game.
Second down and 10 at the 20-yard line. Now McCoy will throw it underneath and incomplete. That ball thrown a little low for Marcus Johnson.
And that's a missed opportunity right there. Johnson was open on the post route going inside. And Case McCoy's got to put it on him there. It's a wide open shot on a first down throw. Excuse me, on a second down throw. It should have been delivered. Tough one for him.
Case McCoy last week against Oklahoma State. 26-39, 221 yards, no touchdowns, and 3 interceptions. Third and 10.
So Tech's going to take a timeout. The beauty of Case McCoy, he shakes off plays and gets right back to it in a hurry. He's got a terrific demeanor about him.
So 6:09 to go in the first. Texas with the ball down by 7. A full week of football continues tomorrow on Fox College Football, presented by K Jewelers, with Washington State battling Washington on Fox. Then on Fox Sports 1, FIU squares off against Florida Atlantic, and Oregon State looks to upset 13th-ranked Oregon. Saturday on Fox Sports 1, it's K-State versus Kansas and Iowa State taking on West Virginia. Then 25th-ranked Notre Dame battling 8th-ranked Stanford on Fox. Fox Sports is your home for college football all week long.
Pretty good smorgasbord of games there with a lot of meaning and bowl implications and who's going to win conference titles and the whole deal.
That's right. And that leftover turkey should last until Monday. So plenty to eat and plenty of football to watch on Fox. Joe Bergeron checks in. He's wearing number 32, Jonathan Gray's number, this evening. Here's McCoy trying to set up a screen, and it's incomplete.
Well, that was well defended there. Sam Aguavin, number 13, was in the face of Case McCoy. But number 54, D'Artuan Bush, the defensive end, read the screen very well. And it had gone ahead and affixed himself to the receiver, Bergeron, and helped cause the incompletion.
So that brings on Anthony Farrow, one of three finalists for the Lou Groza Award. He's made 13 field goals in a row, and he's fifth in the nation in field goal percentage at 94%. This one up from 37 yards away and good. So Anthony Farrow remains hot. Texas on the board, 6 minutes to play in the first. We've got a 7-3 football game in Austin.
But somehow he and his teammates trying to find a way to crack the code to get a win. Haven't won since what, October 19th?
That's right. Baker Mayfield threw for 314 yards, 4 touchdowns, and an interception against Baylor. Terrific game. Also rushed for 39 yards. Bears a little bit too much. Texas sending it away. Marquez and Reginald Davis back deep. This one goes out of the end zone, and Texas Tech will start from the 25. Baker Mayfield,
a walk-on. A true freshman walk-on, and I keep coming back to that as we look at the ball control. Plays pretty well even, but look at Tech with the yards versus Texas. But Mayfield, I'm still stunned that we could have walk-on next to his name. He turned down scholarship offers from Washington State and Mike Leach, Florida Atlantic, Rice. I think he really wanted to go to TCU is the word. They weren't sure, and he ends up walking on at Texas Tech, and they're glad that they have him.
First down at 10 of the 25, Mayfield 4 of 6, 31 yards. Uncorks this one close to the first down marker. And this ball caught by Eric Ward, the senior from Wichita Falls, Texas. And Ward quietly has had a terrific season.
How about his career overall? Came into tonight with 31 touchdown passes in his career, over 2,700 yards receiving.
And they'll run it to Dale Foster, picks up the first down. But there is a flag on the play close to midfield.
Illegal substitution, defense, penalty is declined. Result of the play, first down.
Watch, there's Dalton Santos, 55, trying to come off the field. Josh Turner, 5, trying to get on the field. Santos not quite off the field when the ball snapped. Mack Brown has been talking with the officials about the substitution rule. If they substitute, you have to allow the defense to match up. If the officials are saying we're allowing them to do that, you're just not getting them all off the field in time.
So a first down at the 38-yard line for Texas Tech. Here's Mayfield. He'll check down. Kenny Williams goes nowhere. Terrific pursuit led by Cedric Reed.
That was tremendous, wasn't it? Cedric Reed's a defensive end. Steve Edmond, number 33, is a linebacker. And watch them both get out fast to the bottom of your screen and bottle up the running back and not allow him to get inside. Kenny Williams is trying to make a move, but the defensive end and the linebacker beat him to the spot and force him back in.
A loss of 1, second down and 11 at the 37. Mayfield over the middle this time. Amaro bobbled it, and it's picked off. Duke Thomas with the football at midfield, still running, and finally out of bounds inside Texas Tech territory.
Watch Amaro in the slot going up the field. He's working against number 31, Leroy Scott, and then he beats him inside, but the ball gets popped up in the air off of his hands. He took a wicked hit against Baylor in their last game on a similar route. And this ball popped up off of his hands, didn't take the big hit, but because it was popped in the air, the tip drill came into play, and Duke Thomas, who already had a sack in the game, now picks up an interception.
Tech is now 121st in the country in turnover margin, committing 29 and forcing just 16. First down and 10 of the 44 for Texas. Joe Bergeron in the game, and they'll give it to him. Bergeron crosses the line of scrimmage with a stiff arm and gets out of bounds, but a flag on the play at the 33. Trey Porter shoving him out of play.
Guys, you remember we were here a couple of seasons ago and Bergeron destroyed Texas Tech running the football?
That's right. As a freshman, he set career highs.
Holding, number 81 offense, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, first down.
That's Greg Daniels. As a freshman, Bergeron set career highs of 29 carries for 191 yards versus Texas Tech, and he scored three touchdowns.
I think really the only thing that held him back that day, he had a cramp in his hamstring, and they pulled him off a little bit early. But he's had fumbling problems during this season, a key one at Iowa State, a key one against Oklahoma, and he's lost a little bit of confidence with the coaching staff. Looks like he's getting an opportunity to get it back this evening.
First down and long for Texas. Texas Tech showing blitz. They back out of it. Case McCoy on the roll. Oh, dangerous play. Justice Nelson, the freshman from Mesquite, Texas, almost coming up with the interception. And they love Justice Nelson in Lubbock.
Got his first start last week against Baylor and the bright lights and the big stage against then undefeated Baylor. And their bevy of receivers did not faze him. He gave up a touchdown early, but spent the whole evening doing a nice job in coverage. Almost came up with a key interception on that play.
So second down and 14 as McCoy looks over to the sideline for the play. Texas at the Texas Tech 48-yard line. McCoy with time all day. Elects to run it. McCoy looking for a hole. And he fumbles the football. Texas Tech has it. McCoy blown up. Will Smith, Terrence Bullock combining on the tackle.
As he was running, he did not see really Bullock coming in. And Smith, as you noted, makes the first tackle. Bullock with the big hit on top, hits the football with his shoulder. Look at him going in with the shoulder. And right there, knocks it free. And Texas Tech comes up with a turnover, the key turnover that they need. You remember what Cliff Kingsbury told Christina Pink in pregame? We've turned it over in our losses. They need to start getting takeaways, and there's one for Texas Tech.
Pete Robertson with the recovery for the Red Raiders.
Early on the field was fumble recovered by Texas Tech.
Now here's
previous
what's
play is under further review.
Here's what's going to be the issue. Look at the hit happening, but look here. Knees are on the ground. So if his knees are on the ground here, this may be coming back, folks.
And McCoy hurt.
He took a heck of a shot there in the open field from Terrence Bullock.
Case McCoy quickly back on his feet. He knows he has a chance to go back in there.
But what he's heard is that this fumble may be overturned. And guess what? You feel a lot better if you know that the fumble didn't actually happen.
Let's bring in our rules analyst, Mike Pereira.
Yeah, I'll tell you, tight play, but I think the hand securely on the ball with the right knee on the ground, and they'll actually freeze frame it under the hood. And to me, I think you reverse this to the runner being down.
And some audio difficulties right now coming from Los Angeles as you take another look.
And at full speed, you can see why it's called a fumble. I mean, that's a bang, bang play. But when you look at it on replay, you see McCoy's knees are clearly down before the hit occurs and the ball pops out.
Yeah.
You see on the sideline, there is Terrence Bullitt getting the broken hand that he's been playing with for a few weeks re-wrapped. He also has a very bad left shoulder. So he's been playing with a lot of guts over the last few weeks of this season. Trey Porter has a broken hand at safety for Texas Tech. Also playing. There you go. Both knees appear to be down right there. The hit has not occurred. I think this one's going to come back and Texas is going to benefit. And if you're Texas Tech, you know what you need to do on the other sideline? Make sure your defense is up and ready to go. Don't let it feel like this is a surprise when it gets overturned. Whenever there's a review, you should have both units
up. After further review, the runner's knee was down prior to the ball coming out. It'll be 3rd and 7 at the 41. 3rd and 7 at the 41.
See Terrence Bullitt coming out, getting a little help with his chin strap because of the broken hand. And now the thing Texas Tech cannot do is mentally let down because the turnover didn't occur. They still have the advantage at 3rd and 7 defensively.
There's Bullitt. Hand wrapped up.
That's a tough kid there, Gus.
Yes, very tough. He's played through pain virtually the entire season.
Had a chance to meet him later, last time we were in Lubbock. Actually spoke to his class. He came hustling over after a practice to make class that night.
3rd down and 7 at the 41. Bergeron at tailback with McCoy. Here's McCoy to throw it. In trouble, McCoy. And McCoy written down by Will Smith. Great pressure by Texas Tech, and that's a 10-yard loss.
I'm not sure anyone's playing inside linebacker better than Will Smith is. Watch him back here. And watch him straight ahead pursuit to the quarterback. Falls in behind, and then as McCoy gets flushed, he runs him down in the open field. 16 tackles against Baylor. He's off to a tremendous start tonight.
Ferris sends it away. Jordan Davis back deep. And this one shanked out of bounds. So Texas Tech will get very good field position to start their drive at the 39. Let's flash back. November 1st, 2008. Texas and Texas Tech. Tech trailing 33-32. 8 seconds remaining. Mike Leach watched. Graham Harrell. A 28-yard touchdown pass to Michael Crabtree with 1 second remaining, and they storm the field in Lubbock. Tech winning it 39-33.
Remember, Tech went to number 2 in the country after that and then got beat at Oklahoma, ended up a 3-way tie for the Big 12 title. And Oklahoma got the nod to go to the Big Bowl.
Here's Mayfield running the option this time after the 12-yard punt from Farrah. And Malcolm Brown brings him to the turf after the 5-yard gain. Second and 5. Baker Mayfield throwing off his back foot up the sideline for Ward, and he catches it. Eric Ward with the grace of a ballerina. What a catch. 32 yards.
And Carrington Bynum, number 33, the corner, is actually in good position but just can't locate the football.
Now Kenny Williams running it left. He stood up and driven backwards. He may have lost a yard on the play. Jackson Jeffcoat with the tackle.
This is a well-thrown football, a good route by Ward, but Bynum's in a position where he's got a chance to make a play and can't do it. And how about Ward's concentration all the way through on the catch?
2nd down and 9 at the Texas 23. Trips at the bottom of your screen. Twins at the top. Empty backfield for young Baker Mayfield. And that one deflected at the line of scrimmage. Second time that's happened. This time it's Phillips.
And again, no one is able to get out and put a body on the blitzer to get his arms down out of the passing lane. and that helped knock it away. Look at the total yardage. Texas Tech really piling it up here in the early going.
Third down and 9 at the 23. They need to get inside the 15 for first down.
It's only targeted Amaro, number 22, once in this game.
Amaro in the slot at the bottom of your screen. Mayfield under pressure. He's got a lane if he can break it, and he does. Baker Mayfield slides down, but he will not have enough for first down. Adrian Phillips giving chase.
He did have room to operate, but right about here, Jackson Jeffcoat, who's playing with a little bit of flu-like symptoms, held him up just enough, and here comes everyone else. He gets a foot on him, breaks his stride just a little bit, and here comes Adrian Phillips and the rest of the crew.
So Ryan Busted in to attempt a 35-yard field goal.
And Texas is backed off. They're ready to play fake. Look at the defensive alignment.
Delay of game, kicking team, 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
The only thing I can think of with that is maybe Texas was onto something, that maybe there was a fake, there was a possibility, and they were reading it and maybe calling the fake off and going back to kick the field goal. Because it really shouldn't be a delay when you're just going to line up and kick a field goal. Read the clock, have the ball snap. Maybe Texas backing off, talk them out of it.
So instead of a 35-yarder, they back it up. Buston will attempt a 40-yarder. He's made 8 field goals in a row. And this one is no good. The streak ends at 8. 1:02 to play. First quarter, 7-3, Texas Tech.
The more you look, go back to that, look at it. Remember how they backed off Gus? It looked like an umbrella formation on defense. Like, okay, we're going to play the fake. You go ahead and kick it. It's almost like Texas Tech saw it and said, okay, you saw us. You think we're going to fake it? We got to call it off. They get a penalty. The very next time, Texas lines up like they're going to come after it. He kicks it, hooks it, and as you noted, the streak of 8 straight ended on that one. I mean, he'd only missed 3 all year coming into this, but you see right here, this is the previous play. Texas's alignment suggested they were ready for the fake.
So the Longhorns take over at the 23. Joe Bergeron with a first down and more. Bergeron still on his feet. Bergeron down at midfield. A 27-yard gain. Tanner Jacobson with the tackle.
How about the right side of Texas's line? Mason Walter, 72. Freshman Kent Kirk at 76, getting his first start.
So a first down. Bergeron again, this time straight ahead.
And it looks like Kennedy Estelle, 77, is now in the game at right tackle. The normal starter.
Bergeron coming off the field. There's Kennedy Estelle.
And that run we saw on first down, that looked a lot like the one we saw in 2011, didn't it?
Certainly did. Malcolm Brown back in at running back. Johnson in motion. Deep drop. McCoy going for everything. He's got a receiver. Caught. Touchdown. Mike Davis, the good doctor. 47 yards. Last week, Davis, 9 catches, 112 yards, his 9th 100-yard game. And he's had some success against Texas Tech in the past. Last year, he caught 4 balls for 165 and 2 scores. A big one here as McCoy dropped the biscuit right in the basket.
About the benefits of a good running game, because they were running it so effectively. They fake it inside. They have ghost motion in the backfield with the receiver. Double fake. That's essentially a one receiver route where he beats the freshman, Justice Nelson, 31, and another freshman walk-on, Tanner Jacobson, number 20. no one else really in the route. They just allowed Davis to run past everyone with the two fakes, held everyone at the line of scrimmage, and the blocking held up.
Ninth touchdown pass of the season for Case McCoy.
Well, that's how you honor Jonathan Gray's number, isn't it? Run the football well, take care of it. Look at the scoring drive. The 47-yard touchdown catch by Davis was the payoff. They missed the field goal prior to that. But Texas's running game starting to take effect, and it opens up the avenues for the rest of the playbook.
So Nick Rose ready to kick it away. Bradley Marquez and Reginald Davis are back deep. And this went into the end zone for a touchback. Baker Mayfield comes back on. His team trailing 10-7. Seconds remaining in the first quarter.
This Texas defense, which has really improved since Greg Robinson took over prior to the Ole Miss game, have an opportunity now to increase the momentum for their team if they can get a stop. There's Greg Robinson, longtime defensive coordinator, getting things done. First three games, Texas has given up almost 310 yards a game rushing. Since then, 132 yards per game.
All batted down for the third time at the line of scrimmage. It's the second time Quandre Diggs has gotten a hand on the football.
And also in those first three games, they only had two sacks. Since then, the pressure's been able to be ramped up because the running game's gotten better. The run defense gotten better. They have 24 sacks. And they don't have that tonight, but they have a lot of pressure in the face of Baker Mayfield and are batting a lot of passes away in the backfield.
Second down and 10, Mayfield. This ball is caught by Eric Ward. And that'll take us to the end of the first quarter. Big strike, Case McCoy to Mike Davis. Texas up on Thanksgiving Day here on Fox College.
Well, Ryan Ertzleben helped wake us up with the fake punt, run for a touchdown. And if you nod it off in between, then Case McCoy and Mike Davis woke you up with a big strike for a touchdown for Texas.
Third down and 6 at the 29. DeAndre Washington in the backfield. Here's Mayfield, steps up in the pocket. He won't go anywhere. Second sack of the evening for Texas, and that's Cedric Reed.
And what Texas is doing a nice job here of taking away Baker Mayfield's running lanes when he wants to flush. Watch, they get pressure on him. But look at Reggie Wilson, 92. He circles behind to make sure he can't flush, but he never got there because Cedric Reed took care of things in the backfield.
So Texas Tech forced to punt it away. Here's Ertzleben from the 10, drives his football. Shipley backpedaling, starts from the 30. And Shipley crosses the 35 up to close to the 37-yard line. Now it's time for tonight's stat comparison presented by Ford Motor Company.
Running the plays they've run pretty well even. Rush yards, Texas Tech actually out-rushing them. That's a big part due to Ryan Ertzleben's fake punt that carried him into the end zone. Penalties, 5 of them for Texas Tech so far. Not unusual. That's what they do throughout. That's what they've been doing throughout the season, trying to get that cut down and run even more plays against this Texas defense.
So first down and 10 at the 37. Colt McCoy motioning Shipley. And they'll hand it off. Malcolm Brown sliding through the hole. Will Smith finally brings him down.
Malcolm Brown, the last two games, averaging about 27 carries per game. But it looks like he's going to get some help from Joe Bergeron tonight, getting an increased number of carries, many more than he's had in recent weeks.
Second and 6. Brown again. And Brown wrapped up after a 2-yard gain.
Thank you.
Third and four. Here's McCoy. Sidearms it. Ball caught, but not enough for first down as Saunders makes the catch. Bruce Jones to take down Kendall Sanders.
Remember earlier in the game on a third and long, Jones ended up giving up the first down catch to Mike Davis. On that play, he was determined to guard the first down marker, and he did, and was able to make the tackle and keep Texas from picking it up.
So Anthony Farrah in the punt. His last punt traveling 12 yards.
And he almost kicked his up back because of the timing of the play was thrown off on the snap.
This time he gets off a doozy. Jordan Davis. And he has it at the 11-yard line. A 44-yard punt. 12-16 to play, second quarter, three-point game. Take five. Think they'll ever play again?
I think eventually, but it's going to take some time. Because right now, feelings are pretty hard with both sides about doing that. Did you notice what set him up for that field goal? Case McCoy's leg, something that they say he doesn't really possess. He did it on that night.
Mayfield trying to use his legs now. Throwing on the run, incomplete. Chase Amaro, the intended receiver. And an injured Longhorn on the field. Looks like Steve Edmond, the junior.
See what happens with Edmond. Circling out, trying to cover, and he takes a heck of a block from Eric Ward. And that's one of the great dimensions of Ward's game, is his terrific blocker. Now, he took a pretty good shot himself, looked like he was hurt on the play, but Edmond never saw him coming. The best way to equate that is, like, think of it as basketball. When a guy's guarding someone and no one calls the screen from the backside or the opposite side from you, and you're just running into a wall. And that's what happened to Edmond. Now, Eric Ward took some brunt, too. Now, Eric Ward is 6'205" listed. Steve Edmond, 6'3", 245, down from 270 last year. So when this collision happened, Ward was bringing the hit right there. And it was a clean hit, no helmet involved. But Ward, that's a lot of man that he was running into. He took a little bit of that blow, too.
Eric Ward grabbing his lower back. And with 12.
They beat Oklahoma for the first time since 2009 convincingly. That led to a six-game winning streak before losing last game out against Oklahoma State at home. But Texas, Coach Mac Brown, still in the chase for a Big 12 title. We see Steve Edmond, their linebacker, who took a really wicked hit. Eric Ward, the wide receivers. We take a look here to the right side of your screen, folks. 18 in white going inside. There's the block on Edmond, and that's why we're in that situation. See, Eric Ward, number 18. Eric Ward, that block reminded us of Hines Ward.
Hines Ward.
A wide receiver with toughness, the ability to block on the perimeter, not afraid to go inside. He hurt himself a little bit, but looks like he's bounced back. Eric Ward's had a terrific career at Texas Tech, not just catching the ball, but blocking for everyone else.
Edmond, the team's leading tackler, came into the game with 72 tackles. Also a couple of interceptions.
He's really starting to play well, too, Gus.
Had 9 tackles in their last game against Oklahoma State. So,
and saved their game against West Virginia with an interception in the end zone in overtime. That game, he was a monster. 12 tackles, a pass broken up, and an interception. Really starting to grasp what Greg Robinson was teaching on defense.
Second down and 10 at the 12-yard line. Mayfield to the sideline. Ball caught. And this time it's Reginald Davis with the reception as he goes up high to get it. Third down and 4. Tech 1-5 on third down conversion. Kenny Williams in the backfield. Here's Mayfield. Scrambling. Mayfield looking for the first down and won't get it. Texas well schooled on this Texas Tech offense. And the Red Raiders come up empty once again. They need about a yard for first down.
They're looking at it close over there about whether he got it or not. That dive at the end may have gotten him, but it definitely got him in position for them to look at it. Shiro Davis, number one, chasing him and making the tackle. Let's see the extension by Mayfield. See him reaching out there? It's a matter of where that mark, where the spot was, will it be close enough for him to get it? Look at that. That much short. Now, all conventional wisdom says punt the ball away. But when you've lost four games in a row, you might not do that if you're Cliff Kingsbury. If you can't get that much, it goes to thinking.
Well, I'm going to quote a man that I worked with last time Texas Tech played against Baylor, and he said, if they do go for it on fourth down, you better throw it.
Yeah, running the ball inside has not been a strength of the Texas Tech offense for the longest time. The only way you would do it now is if you put Mayfield under center and sneak it. But if they go with their regular gun formation, I would throw the ball rather than chance running the football even at that short of a distance.
Texas Tech looks like they're still thinking about it. Now the referee is going over to the sideline, and he'll take a look.
They may be reviewing this about spot, where the ball was spotted. There's Shiro Davis with the tackle. Mayfield still in bounds. Now he's reaching. Where do you put the ball down on the spot? That's difficult. Give Baker Mayfield credit, trying to squeeze every inch out of this play. A good hustle by Shiro Davis from the defensive end position to pursue him. Otherwise, it would have been an easy first down. See the ball being extended? Right behind it, you see the flag that they put down to kind of mark where it is, but that's not official. And it looks like it's ahead of that flag, but again, remember, that's not an official mark. See, the feeder's feet stay in bounds. They're in the air now. They've never come down. So you can't establish him out yet until there. Ball's extended and the foot's coming down.
And they're probably trying to establish where across the sideline as well.
But that sideline, remember, extends. He's in the air, as we noted before. And that extends all the way to the stands. So it's a long way to go.
Let's bring in Mike Pereira. So Mike Pereira, unable to get him right now. In the meantime, Charles, a big decision coming up for Cliff Kingsbury if he doesn't pick up the first down here.
After further review, the runner got beyond the 22, therefore it's a first down.
Well, that's a decision he doesn't have to make. Now he gets back into regular offense. See him extending out. Really good effort by Baker Mayfield. And you see the ball over the yellow line, which is our first down marker.
So a first down and 10 at the 22-yard line for Texas Tech. Sadale Foster, Kenny Williams out of the split backfield. And this time they'll give it to Kenny Williams. Tries to turn the corner, but goes nowhere. Adrian Phillips. First man to him, Reggie Wilson also there.
That was a really nice play by Wilson, number 92. The defensive end was able to play off the block, get outside, and Williams unable to turn the corner. Forced back inside where Phillips helped clean up.
Second down and 8 at the 24. Here's Mayfield, sideline, and it's caught. This time, the reception going to DJ Polite-Bray.
A freshman lightly used for the season. That's his second catch for the year.
Makes it third down and two at the 30-yard line. Here's Mayfield, far side. Amaro just dropped it. He had the first down and more. Jason Morrow taking his eyes off the football, and Texas Tech will have to punt.
And really, that's the second one he's dropped. Remember the one he bobbled that popped in the air and became an interception for Duke Thomas? That's one he normally would have grabbed. Second one that he's dropped this evening right in his mitts. Very unusual for Jason Morrow this season.
Ryan Erksleben punting for the third time. This one, a low kick. And will be down at the 42. 10-17 to play, second quarter. 10 can get Alabama.
They've got a shot. Game's at home. They're playing awfully well. And they're not going to be intimidated as normal teams are because it's a rivalry game. To them, it's an opportunity. It's nothing to be fearful of. I still say Alabama wins, but I think Auburn's going to challenge them.
Here's Joe Bergeron. Nice move for Bergeron as he gets to midfield. Joe Bergeron with some terrific running in this first half. Justice Nelson finally brings him down after a 16-yard gain.
If I were the Texas coaches, I would tell Joe Bergeron every week that they're playing Texas Tech. He responds when he sees the Red Raiders. When he sees that double T on the side of the helmets, he plays.
Four carries, 52 yards for the junior from Mesquite, Texas. First down and 10 at the 43. Here's McCoy, deep drop. Dumps it off in the flats. Bergeron, first down. As he gets to the Texas Tech 29-yard line, Trey Porter, the safety, makes the stop.
Now, Texas had been very deliberate in their last couple of drives. Now they're going to speed up the pace a little bit. And here's McCoy off of a short drop, able to dump it off.
Bergeron again. And this time, Texas Tech will drop him for a short gain. Pete Robertson and Kerry Hyder combining on the tackle. Here's Jonathan Gray on the sideline. Achilles injury ended his season. Second and 8 at the 27.
Notice after the momentum plays, Texas goes quicker. When they don't have a momentum play, they get a little more deliberate.
Bergeron breaks a tackle. Flag on the play as Bergeron finally wrapped up inside the 20 by Sam McGuavin.
If that penalty's not against Texas, Jeff Swaim, number 82, threw one of the better blocks you'll see on the line of scrimmage.
Holden, number 82, offense, 10-yard penalty, second down.
Now we know why it was such a good block. Because he absolutely manhandled the defensive end on that play and ended up catching him with a hold.
Swaim, a junior from Chico, California, Pleasant Valley High School. Great size for tight end, 6'4", 250-plus.
And a tremendous blocker. Even after that play where they caught him with his hands, catching some cloth.
Second down and 13. Malcolm Brown back in at running back for Texas. McCoy looks up and incomplete. Mike Davis was open. That ball goes sailing out of bounds. Bruce Jones covering for the Red Raiders.
You have no chance on a play close to the sideline when the ball's thrown that far over the sideline. There's an opportunity. Look at the top of your screen. Davis working against Bruce Jones. They catch Jones false stepping. It's almost as if Jones thinks he's got help behind him. It almost looks like he's playing zone. No one behind him and the ball thrown over the sideline, so Davis has no opportunity.
So that makes it third down and 13 at the 32. Texas needs to go to the Tech 19 for a first down. McCoy. Spinning out of trouble. McCoy dumps it off. And incomplete. Malcolm Brown had two hands on the football, couldn't hold on. Bruce Jones throws himself under the chariot, and he's hurt.
The Mighty Mouse really put a lick on Malcolm Brown, who ended up going low on the play. Talk about Bruce Jones, who's 5'7", 180. Watch him come in here and hit Brown. Ball bounced away from Brown before Jones made the hit. So the hit didn't knock it away. Jones missed the pass. Excuse me, Brown misses the pass. Good exit by McCoy. Thinks he's got a target and does, but the ball goes off of Brown. Then Jones makes the hit afterwards. Brown fortunate to actually be getting to get up like that after having been hit low by Bruce Jones. The ball's gone, but right there with the shoulder and head on the knee. So sometimes what you get is the leg coming through and getting the head with a lot of a whiplash effect right here on the tackle. And you see how his head ended up turning because of where he hit on the knee and thigh area. And you're bringing out the board now for Bruce Jones.
Jones was moving his legs. And most of the time, folks, when the crew comes out, it looks more severe than it actually is. They're doing this, though, for precautionary purposes to make sure that the athlete gets the best care possible.
And where it gets tough for teams is you have that concern about the young man on the field. Both squads do, but also trying to stay in the game. Because when the game starts up again, how do you make sure that switch is flipped again to go back to play the way that you were playing before with the same type of emotion and aggression?
Let me correct myself. Jones from Eastvale, California, Roosevelt High School.
You know, he played linebacker in high school.
At 5'7".
You look at that man. And you can see by the way he's played tonight.
He's got a linebacker's mentality.
He does. He'll come up and strike you in a heartbeat. That's not a problem for him. I only hope he's going to be okay.
Mac Brown. His team with a 10-7 advantage. And Coach Kingsbury pacing the sideline.
Terrific scene of sportsmanship here. You see a lot of people with the horns up sign in the stands actually showing support for the young man on the field by doing it that way.
Yeah, I tell you what, these crews, folks.
There's a Texas Tech Red Raider fan with the guns up.
These crews, folks, that come out and service the athletes, work so hard. They're out there practicing,
yes,
before the game, just like the players.
And they go through the drills and the scenarios, just as you said, Gus. In my past life, I worked for the Olympic Committee, and we did that sort of a thing and had a young man who was almost paralyzed in an accident, and our crew had gone over that type of scenario previously and saved that. It was tremendous.
Before being strapped down, Bruce Jones did move his legs. And he gives a thumbs up. Takes a lot of courage to play this game. And as we've seen, Charles, over the years, it's gotten a lot more violent. These players are just incredible specimens. Bigger, faster, stronger.
Trained so well now.
There's Jones.
That's wonderful. And you know who else is over at the cart? Mac Brown, the head coach of Texas, going over to check on the young man.
So we will pass along the information on Bruce Jones. I'm sure Christina Pink will look into his status. We'll pass that information along to you as soon as we have something. So now Anthony Farrah. comes in to attempt a 49-yarder, his career-long 50. He's made a 37-yarder tonight. Got it away. And good. Anthony Farah gives Texas a 13-7 lead with 8:18 to play in the second quarter.
That young man's had some kind of year, hasn't he? One missed kick all year. He's a transfer from Penn State. He left after the sanctions had come down and everyone was given a chance to transfer without penalty, and he took it and came here. A lot of family members have gone through the University of Texas. He agonized over leaving Penn State and caught a lot of criticism from people back there about leaving. A horrible website, ripping him, and he's been able to put that behind him. Had a bad groin last year that didn't allow him to kick normally. Had to get that healed. And having a banner year, one of the finalists for the Lou Groza Award, which is a top kicker in college football, one of three finalists, and you see why tonight.
So Farah does handle the place kicking and the punting, but Nick Rose is Texas's kickoff specialist. He'll send it away from the 35. This one into the end zone for yet another touchback. Now Fox Sports is proud to team with Feeding America, a nationwide network of food banks that helps feed more than 37 million people in America each year through pantries, soup kitchens, and shelters. Visit feedingamerica.org/foxsports to learn how you can fight hunger in your community.
Big drive here for Texas Tech, Gus. They've got to find a way to move the football. Not much of a running game. Baker Mayfield's legs have not come into play as much because Texas has done a much better job of taking that away than they did against Clint Shelf of Oklahoma State.
Here's a screen. Marquez inside. And once again, Cedric Reed is Johnny on the spot as he makes the tackle. Jackson Jeffcoat there as well.
How about Cedric Reed? That's a defensive end who's charged with rushing the quarterback, comes off the pass rush, and comes and makes the tackle. Marquez with another catch.
Second down and three at the 32. Mayfield runs it, and he won't get the first down. Josh Turner getting to him quickly.
Your teams talk all the time about self-scouting. What didn't we do well previously? Against Oklahoma State, they didn't take away the quarterback run game very well. You can see the benefits of the 12 days in between. So far, the defense for Texas much improved in that area.
Third down and two of the 33.
I need a timeout.
And Texas Tech will use a timeout here.
Timeout, Texas Tech. Their second of the half, 30 seconds in length.
7:09 to go here in the second quarter. Now Saturday on Fox Sports 1, live from Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas, it's the most explosive Ultimate Fighter finale yet. A pivotal rematch ignites as Gray Maynard takes on Nate Diaz, and this season's finalists take one last step in chase of their dream. The Ultimate Fighter finale live Saturday at 8 p.m. Eastern on Fox Sports 1. Great show on Fox Sports 1 prior to the beginning of our broadcast. Looking at back at some of the old MMA days, old UFC days, Royce Gracie.
Quick question.
Yes.
Rousey and Tate. Do we get them to go? Do they get to go at it?
I'm not sure.
In the final? That would be fun.
Not in the final, but I think they're going to stage a fight between those young ladies.
Wow.
After the final is over.
Now that's one I want to see. That's going to be a heck of a fight.
I don't know. I think Misha may get it.
Wouldn't that be something? Because, you know, the public thinks Ronda Rousey can't be beat.
Ronda Rousey's got some bullying. Third down and two with the 33. Here's Mayfield. dropping it off. DeAndre Washington, first down, gets to the 40, cuts it inside, and up to the 45, a nice gain of 12 yards.
And I love it because of what Texas Tech did. That was a situation of knowing thyself. Showed a heavy run formation, faked it inside, got to the perimeter, and picked up the first down.
From the 45, Eric Ward with the catch, has a block in front of him, looks for the first down and gets it as he goes out of bounds inside Texas territory. Carrington Bindham upending him after a 12-yard gain.
Cannot run those types of plays if the other receivers will not block. Bradley Marquez did a nice job blocking on the perimeter, allowed Ward to cut inside and pick up the 12 yards.
Ward, four catches, 57 yards. First down and 10 of the 43. Here's Mayfield. Goes up the sideline and incomplete. Ward, the intended receiver, Bindham covering.
And on that play, good coverage by Carrington Bindham. But I know Dwayne Aquina, his secondary coach, would tell him that should be an interception. You've got position. You've got a chance to drive back to the football, but is unable to do it. Maybe it has something to do with the hand. You see that hand heavily wrapped, his right hand? Maybe he can't grasp the football, and the best he could do is knock it down. In any event, good positioning by Carrington Bindham.
Second down and long. And Mayfield, unable to connect with Edwards, brings up third and long.
And now we want to see if Greg Robinson comes with the heat. He's got two really good defensive ends in Reed and Jeffcoat. But so far tonight, he's shown that he likes to bring more than four at the passer, especially in passing situations.
Third down and 10 at the 43. Out of the gun, Mayfield under pressure and is sacked. Jackson Jeffcoat storming in, fourth sack of the evening for the Longhorns.
And what they did is they took Jackson Jeffcoat out of his normal defensive end position and put him in the middle. This is him as a stand-up guy now. Watch him play a game up front with number 90, Malcolm Brown. Brown takes on two, twists behind him, and Jeffcoat puts down Mayfield.
Eighth sack of the season for Jackson Jeffcoat. Tied for second in the Big 12 and 21st in Division I.
Those flu-like symptoms improved for Jackson Jeffcoat, didn't they?
Rashad Fortenberry, the injured Red Raider, starting right tackle.
He's had a tough career with injuries. Fortenberry, he's had back, ankle, knee. This is the first year he had gotten through the bulk of the season without it. And here he is getting dinged up a little bit now. Let's hope he can come back before this game is over.
So Texas Tech with 6:01 to go before halftime. Prepared to punt it away. Erksleben at the 37. Jackson Shipley back deep. He's at his own 10. End over end kick. And it will be down inside the 20-yard line. So the Texas run game, they told us when we met with them at their facility yesterday, they were going to pound it, and they are pounding the football against the Red Raiders.
And the best thing is that they've shown some patience and willingness to stick with it. Early in the game, it wasn't working very well. Texas Tech was doing a nice job defending it. But as the game has gone on, because Major Applewhite, the offensive coordinator, has stuck with it, the offensive line, receivers, tight ends have now started to chop some holes into the front of Texas Tech, and the runners are getting through it, averaging nearly 5 yards a carry.
First down and 10 at the 20-yard line. And they hand it off, Malcolm Brown. And look at Malcolm Brown. A 13-yard gain. Meanwhile, let's go downstairs to Christina Pink for an injury update.
Well, Gus, Tech cornerback Bruce Jones is still in the stadium being evaluated by the training staff. No specifics on exactly what the injury is, but they have not transported him to a hospital. They want to evaluate him more. Also, Texas linebacker Steve Edmond being evaluated for a right rib injury after that block from Eric Ward.
All right, Christina, thank you very much. First down and 10 now for Texas. They run the reverse. Shipley wants to throw it. David! Shoulder. A 43-yard gain for Mike Davis.
Watch behind the quarterback. Brown to Shipley. And how about Shipley setting up and throwing it like a quarterback? That could not have been thrown any better by Case McCoy.
Malcolm Brown running now. And he'll churn his legs and get about 8 yards on the play. Trey Porter with the tackle. Texas keeping Texas Tech off balance. Mike Davis already over 100 yards in the first half. Brown again looking for the first down. Will be close. It will depend on the spot.
Gus, if Jackson Shipley was a baseball player, you know what the evaluation of him would be?
What would it be?
Five-tool player. Can do it all. I mean, look at what we see out of him. Catches a football on offense, returns the kicks. Now we saw him throw the football. We know he can run it if you hand it to him on a reverse. And I have no doubt in my mind if they put him on defense, he'd be a nice free safety.
Joe Bergeron is the deep man in the I formation. Bergeron straight ahead, first down.
First down, but a really good tackle, because if that tackle's not made, I think Bergeron sprints into the end zone. He saw the cut that went back away from where the pile was and went for it. If that tackle's not made, he had a great half. Alex De La Torre was leading him, number 36.
Johnson the motion man. Out of the Wildcat formation, Bergeron. And the Texas offensive staff showing a lot of confidence in Joe Bergeron in this game.
We met with him the other day. Did you get the sense that it was like, we're going to give you one more shot? Very upset with him about ball security, taking care of the ball on the ground too much. But the potential is there for him to just wear down a defense at his size and bulk. He's lost 20 pounds since last year, but he's lost none of the punch that he packs when he carries the football.
Second down and 9. Bergeron again. Looking for a hole. Has it. For the end zone. Cuts it inside. Touchdown, Texas. Joe Bergeron recording his fourth rushing touchdown of the season. And with 3:07 to go in the second quarter, Texas takes a 20-7 lead. Ground and pound. UT, no secrets here.
Up here in the Ring of Honor here at the University of Texas, and that's his brother Case McCoy leading his team tonight, also against Texas Tech.
And Colt is one of just 5 quarterbacks in NCAA history to post 4 2,500-yard seasons. And he owns the NCAA record for completion percentage, having completed 77% in 2008. Reginald Davis gets to the 20, 30, and finally down at the 34. Don't forget, coming up, the Pizza Hut halftime report. Rob Stone, Coy Wire, Petros Papadakis will take you around college football, talk about Auburn and their big battle with Alabama coming up. A lot of big games this weekend. Ohio State, Michigan. Ohio State still undefeated with Urban Meyer.
Alabama, big one. Petros' dad played at USC. He played in one of the seminal games in college football history. That USC win in Birmingham, Alabama, that they say helped integrate football in the South.
First down and 10 at the 34. Here's Mayfield. Underneath. Incomplete. Intended for Edwards, but he couldn't hold on. And Texas Tech just looks out of sync offensively tonight.
And the hard part is the score doesn't give you an opportunity to run those deceptives or trick plays that they like to run. Down 20-7. The biggest play they've had tonight was off of the fake punt by Erksleben. But they've really struggled and not been able, as you've noted, to get in sync offensively.
Mayfield again, this time it's Amaro. Out of bounds at the 39, his first catch of the night.
And I think a lot of it has to do with the athletic ability of Texas. They look quicker tonight than they've looked in recent, than they looked against Oklahoma State. Faster to the ball, faster to the point of attack, and the pressure has really been in Baker Mayfield's face all night long when he's tried to throw it.
Third down and five at the 39. Baker Mayfield under pressure. Jeffcoat gets to him again. Second sack of the night for Jackson Jeffcoat. Fifth of the evening for the Texas Longhorns.
Remember we were talking about athletic ability? Watch this. He comes all the way around to make this play. Jackson Jeffcoat. That's a defensive end. He ends up beating the block by LaRaven Clark, and then he runs down the quarterback in the backfield. When you're that athletic and that fast, faster than the players trying to make plays on offense, it's hard to move the football.
Erksleben will punt from his own 16-yard line. Texas trying to get to it. A flag on the play as they run into the punter. Shipley. And Shipley wrapped up another flag thrown. Kenny Williams with the tackle on special teams.
But it looks like Caleb Blewett, number 42, ends up tackling the punter after the ball gets away.
Caleb, excuse the play on words, did
he did exactly what his last name is. Let's see what they penalize him for.
Illegal block in the back on the return team number 3. That penalty is declined. Personal foul, roughing the kicker on the defense, number 42. 15-yard penalty and automatic first down.
Caleb Blewett.
Here's Blewett right here coming through the line. Now your path is supposed to take you to the side or past the punter. They teach you about those angles all the time. His angle was directly into the punter. So as he's falling, he has no place to go but to fall on the punter. So if he didn't get the ball, then he was going to run right into him. And now he's got to contemplate that because that's not how they're teaching you to do it. You're supposed to go across the foot of the punter and either take it off his foot or go past him without running into him.
First down and 10, Mayfield drops it off. Washington with blockers in front of him. Here's Washington still on his feet. And DeAndre Washington with a sensational run after the catch. Finally tracked down by Malcolm Brown, but it's a gain of 32 yards.
And you know who can run really well for Texas Tech besides DeAndre Washington? It's Jared Casper, the center, number 75. He got out in the open field and was pretty much running stride for stride with Washington looking for someone to block. It was so open, I don't remember Casker throwing a block on that play.
So let's see if Texas Tech can capitalize off of the mistake by the Longhorns. The personal foul penalty running into the punter, Cliff Kingsbury. His team started 7-0, folks. At one time ranked number 10 in the nation. Then they met Oklahoma. Things changed.
And the schedule somewhat backloaded. Because in a row, it was Oklahoma, home against Oklahoma State, Kansas State at home, then Baylor in Arlington, Texas. But they've got to fight the culture that says when November comes around, they don't win football games. It's been like that for a number of years now at Tech.
Mayfield. And Mayfield can't break contain as he's ridden out of bounds by Duke Thomas.
Things getting a little testy now. Good stiff arm by Baker Mayfield, but it was good positioning by Duke Thomas on the tackle. But downfield, had a couple of guys locked up in the secondary, and I see a flag on the play.
After the play, on sportsmanlike conduct, number 2 on the defense, number 11 on the offense, those fouls offset, second down.
So that'll be Michael Thompson for Texas and Jakeem Grant
So it should be right here. Jakeem Grant for Texas Tech. It plays over. They're still going at it. Gotta cuff each other in the face mask, then they start whooping.
Second down and 11. Mayfield, again, under pressure, incompleted. Speaking of Jakeem Grant, there's a name that we haven't called in the first half except for that personal foul penalty.
And have you noticed he's not returning kicks? Comes into the game fifth in the conference in kickoff return. I think that there's some things going on where they're trying to make sure Jakeem Grant understands what needs to come first at Texas Tech. He didn't start tonight's game.
Third down and long for the Red Raiders at the Texas 25. Here's Mayfield. Throws to Williams. Flag on the play as Williams goes down about a yard in front of the line of scrimmage. Peter Jenkins.
This might go for Texas Tech, though. It was thrown into the same
personal
quarterback.
Foul, roughing the passer. Number 88 defense. Penalty enforced, pass the distance to the goal. First down.
Top of your screen. Watch 88 get to the backfield. Beats Fortenberry. Ball's clearly gone. And then gives him a little shove at the end. And you know they're going to protect the quarterback. And it's really about 2-3 steps after the ball was gone.
Cedric Reed has been excellent in this first half.
He's been a real force, hasn't he?
Yes, he has.
Not just rushing the quarterback, though. He's making plays in the running game. He's been able to run plays down away from him. His first mistake of the evening.
So first down at the Texas 12-yard line for the Red Raiders. Mayfield keeps it, and he'll dive forward, loses the ball. And Bradley Marquez there to scoop it up. I don't know if Mayfield was down prior to that ball coming out. As Kingsbury wants a timeout.
And that's the one thing that's driving his head coach crazy about Baker Mayfield, is the ball comes free too many times. Three fumbles in the game we had against Baylor. One was lost. Now, he may have been down before the ball came out on that one. But still, coaches do not want to see that ball come free. Yeah, he's saying he's down, down, down. You know, that's one of those things a coach is always going to say. But in film session, that ball should never pop free, Baker Mayfield. That's what Cliff Kingsbury will tell him. And by the way, you know coach's quarterbacks at Texas Tech? Cliff Kingsbury, the head coach. So he'll be right in the room telling him about
that. Texas Tech, their third and final of the half, 30 seconds in length.
Texas Tech out of timeouts. And sometimes you see players trying to get that extra yard, and that's when that fumble takes place.
We've seen a lot with the reaching for the first down marker.
Rolling
right
on the field
and
the
goal
runner
line
was down.
So a lot of the time you're trying to walk that line as a coach between you like the aggression of reaching out, but also where's the ball security? And that's a tough one, right? I want you to go get it, except I don't want you to fumble it. So the kids are like, well, what is it, coach? And bottom line is, frankly, the coach is going to tell you, err on the side of ball security. Take care of the football.
So Cliff Kingsbury, who played for Mike Leach, and he's brought virtually the same system back to Texas Tech.
And I don't think they're thinking about 3 points at all here. Not with four losses in a row. They'll only take it as an absolute last resort. And they're going to do everything they can on this drive to try and punch it in and pay off this drive.
Second down and six. They'll throw the fade to Ward in the corner. He makes a catch. Didn't look like his feet were in bounds. So an incomplete pass.
Well defended by Bindham because he pinned him to the sideline and gave him nowhere to come down with the football. Really good coverage by Bindham. Left of your screen, 23 in the burnt orange. See how he pushes him over the sideline? So even if he comes down with it, which he does, he can't be in bounds. Well played.
Third down and six at the eight. Texas Tech has kicked 20 field goals after getting inside the red zone. No team in the country is settled for more. But they need 6 points here.
Jackson Jeffcoat has been big on the pass rush.
Mayfield, pump fake, in trouble, and goes down at the 15. Jackson Jeffcoat again, partner, you called it, his third sack of the night. No timeouts.
They're scrambling to try and kick the field goal.
Ryan Buston in place, 5 seconds and counting. He's set, got to get it away. It's down, up, and good. A 32-yard field goal as time expires here in the first half. And that takes us to halftime with Texas leading Texas Tech 20-10. Now we go to Rob Stone in Los Angeles for the Pizza Hut halftime, which starts now.
Texas running the ball as they wanted to. 6.8 yards per play for Texas. Very good for them. Six sacks. That's a big number. If Tech wants to get back in it, they've got to find a way to slow down the pass rush of Texas to allow Baker Mayfield an opportunity to try and make some plays.
Jackson Jeffcoat with the career high three sacks in this game already. And he still has another half of football to play. So Texas will receive the kick to start the second half.
Didn't they tell us that Jackson Jeffcoat had flu-like symptoms before the game? Feels a whole lot better, doesn't he?
Texas, Marcus Johnson from the goal line. Johnson crossing the 15 and will twirl his way to the 20. Now let's go downstairs to Christina Pink.
Thanks, Gus. Spoke to Mac Brown at halftime. Even with a 20-10 lead, he said, we should be up more defensively. We're getting pressure, but we're killing ourselves with mistakes on special teams. Also, leading tackler Steve Edmond will not return with an injury to his right rib. Spoke to Cliff Kingsbury and asked him, how do you keep Baker Mayfield upright? He says, we've got to protect better. They're not blitzing us. They're just beating us up front, and Mayfield's got to make quicker decisions.
All right, thank you very much, Christina. First down and 10 at the 20-yard line for the University of Texas. And they'll hand it to Malcolm Brown. On first down, lowers his shoulder, and he'll get to the 30-yard line. Will Smith with the tackle, but he's close to a first down. Malcolm Brown in the first half, 13 carries, 56 yards. He'll run it once again. And what is it about this Texas Tech defense that prohibits them from stopping them?
They're not as stout inside. They've counted on Donnell Wesley to play the nose guard for them and be a really stout force inside. He's not playing tonight with an ankle injury. Wesley checks in at 6'1", 310, and probably a little bit larger than that now. So they've had to move Kerry Hyder inside, and he's really a defensive end at 280. And if you can't control the middle of the line, you're going to have a real struggle against a hard-running team.
Here's Johnson around the corner. And Johnson will dive forward, picks up another first down, lost the ball, but he may be down. Looks like he was down. Texas Tech says no, he wasn't.
And the ball's been awarded to Texas, but what they tell the officials to do is let it play out. Don't blow the whistle early. Because if you do, then the play can't be overturned. They let you play it out to make sure the outcome is correct. Now, was he down before the ball came out is what they'll have to determine. It appeared to me that he was down before the ball popped out on first look.
Ruling on the field was fumble. Previous play is under further review.
Let's take a look. His hand is reaching. The ball is still in his possession. Knee and everything's down. Ball's coming out, but he's already down with his legs. Take a look again. He's reaching out with us. See, right there, the body's already starting to come down before the ball pops out, in my humble estimation. See, at first I thought when he was reaching, the ball may have been working its way free, but he had a full grasp of the football as he started to reach. See, right here, you're thinking, oh, is the ball starting to work? No. See, he's got it. He's got it. That's not a problem. But see, the body's already down back here before the ball starts to work its way out there.
And Charles, has replay made us too precise?
In many ways, I think your answer would be yes. We always talk about getting the call correct, right? And it's always focused on the big calls, calls that decide games, things of that nature. But I think a lot of people sit at home and say, okay, can we play it? You know, because in real time, what's hard for these officials, and watch it in real time, it looks like a fumble. See, with your eye, you know, I think the normal eye, when you're watching that play, that looks like a fumble, bang, bang, play, and we're asking them to decipher that on the run. That's why they tell the officials, let these plays play out and let replay handle it from there. Because if you blow the whistle and you're wrong.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. First down, Texas Tech.
Wow. Now, I'm surprised by that, to be frank with you, because I thought he had firm. I thought he had control of the ball. I thought his body was down, and then the ball came free. But they determined that the ball was working its way free already, and that's why they gave him the fumble.
So Texas, with an early mistake to start the second half. Johnson fumbling. Texas Tech takes over. See if they take a shot. Mayfield drops it off to Williams, and he can't hold on. And Christina Pink's interview with Kingsbury at halftime, very good interview where he revealed that it's not that they're out-scheming us, they're just beating us.
Yeah, well, what's interesting, he said they weren't blitzing, according to Christina. Five of the sacks in the first half came off of blitzes.
Mayfield underneath Eric Ward. Ward will pick up a first down. Nice running after the catch as he gets to the 35.
Eric Ward is not flashy, but he just goes to work, doesn't he? Makes tough catches, blocks, gets extra yardage when you don't think it's there.
Now Mayfield, looks like they're going to try some trickery. That ball loose, and Texas has it. Josh Turner. But they say
it's got to be a lateral.
A lateral.
I mean, I don't know how that can be anything but a lateral. Watch as he throws it, right, as he starts. It's supposed to be a lateral pass, and that actually appeared to be forward. And then the lateral coming back definitely was a lateral throw.
It was backward pass. First down, Texas.
See, the first throw to Davis might very well have been a forward pass. And now he's trying to lateral it back. That'd just be like a broken play where you lateral it back to someone. Watch. Okay, so he's going to throw it. And right here, catches the football. Well, that's fine because now he could lateral if he wants to. But the ball comes free off of his hand, and it was a lateral pass back. Should be a free ball, and Texas on the recovery with Josh Turner.
But the bigger question, why that play in this situation? Down by only 10 in your opponent's end. And Cliff Kingsbury takes an unnecessary.
Hey, the good news is I'm here. I'm actually here. I wasn't out eating turkey like I was last time, but don't know why they reviewed that. It was obviously it was a backward pass.
I mean,
yeah, and they rightfully did confirm it.
They swing it here, and then it's a backwards pass to him, just like it'd be a lateral out in the open field, trying to lateral to a teammate, ball's
right.
Free. So I didn't understand why we needed a long review on that one. That would seem pretty simple. And Mike, they gave it to Texas.
Understood. Yeah.
Well, thank you, Mike. So Texas with the football at their own 49. And that one. Flags on the play.
Illegal snap, number 55 offense. 5-yard penalty, first down.
It's the center, Dominic Espinoza.
So when they say illegal snap, I'm guessing maybe he double clutched on it. Looked like he was trying to snap it, pulled it back, then snapped it afterwards.
First down and 15. McCoy with the handoff. Malcolm Brown. Power running once again for Texas. Brown still on his feet. They can't bring the big guy down. Finally,
now he's flagged.
They toss him down, and it's a flag.
Situation where this play is done. Texas Tech has made the stop, and now they're going to bail Texas out with the flag at the end by not
personal
letting it
foul,
go.
Number 7, defense. 15-yard penalty, an automatic first down.
And they got away, it looked like, with a face mask from Aguavin to start off with. He got his hand off the mask, but whistles are blowing at this point. And then at the end, you're going to throw him down? This play's over. You just hurt your defense. Will Smith, who's been playing so well for Texas Tech in the last couple of weeks, commits a penalty that was just totally unnecessary and hurt his defense.
So that makes it first down and 10 at the Texas Tech 32-yard line. McCoy. Malcolm Brown. And you can just see the confidence building with this Texas Tech, with this Texas, rather, offensive line against this Texas Tech defense.
And now they want to go quicker now. They want to change tempo on Texas Tech and try and catch them unaware.
Brown again. What can Brown do for you? A lot right now.
And he's got good stamina. His carries have really increased in the last few weeks. Came into tonight over the last two games, averaging 27 carries per game. The offensive line playing well, firing off and hitting people. But I'm really impressed with number 82, tight end Jeff Swaim. You don't have a good running game unless you have a tight end who's an inline blocker on the line of scrimmage who can control the point of attack, and Swaim's been doing that this evening.
16 carries, 74 yards for Brown. First down, Texas. Brown again. And he'll just dive forward. Aguavit in the middle, making the stop.
Good play by Texas Tech's front, allowing Aguavit, number 13, the linebacker, to come up and make the tackle. Let's see if Major Applewhite stays with the running game here, which has been pretty effective in the second half.
Second and nine. This time it's McCoy on the keeper, and McCoy chopped down immediately by Tanner Jacobson. He'll gain 2 yards on the play.
You know, you hear a lot of people talk about, you know, Texas needing something from the quarterback run game. That's really not who Case McCoy is. They really would like to see Tyrone Swoops, the backup, come in and run quarterback run game, but they're not comfortable with him in the entire playbook. McCoy gives you a little extra dimension with that, but not the normal one you see with running quarterbacks.
Third down and seven at the 19. Texas needs to go to the 12-yard line for first down. McCoy to throw it. McCoy in trouble. McCoy gets forward, stays on his feet, and picks up a first down and more down inside the 5-yard line on third and seven. Case McCoy gets 16.
Remember that highlight we showed earlier against Texas A&M on a Thanksgiving night when Case McCoy made plays with his legs and helped them win the, get the game-winning field goal? He's not a terrific runner, but he did a nice job of feeling the pressure from behind and staying on his feet and getting a lot out of that play, a lot more than it looked like it was, he was going to be able to get. He just felt that pressure from the backside, didn't he?
Yes.
He was able to flush and get up into the gut of the defense.
Great job holding onto the football. He kind of had it out wide.
It looked a little bit like Johnny Football. Did I say that? An A&M guy holding it out wide like that with a Texas guy? We'll hear about that, won't we? Very deliberate tonight on calls.
Offside defense, contact with the snapper. Penalty being forced half the distance from the goal, first down.
So that'll make it first down and goal at the 1-yard line for Texas.
Any doubt about what this play call is going to be?
Malcolm Brown.
Here he comes. De La Torre, 36, leading.
Malcolm Brown. And he won't get in. Brown denied the end zone. Micah Alway coming up and making the tackle.
Alway only listed about 210 pounds. Nice job inside. I think Brown comes right back at you, though.
Second and goal of the one. It's McCoy. He'll lean forward. Did he get in? Yes, he did. Touchdown, Texas. Second rushing touchdown of the season for Case McCoy. And the Longhorns take a 26-10 lead.
Got wedged in there. Espinosa, 55 in the middle, the center of the pivot. Walter, 72. Estelle, 77 at right tackle. Trey Hopkins, left guard, 75. Donald Hawkins, 51, left tackle. Created the wedge in the middle for McCoy to fall into the end zone. He earned that one with the scramble on a third down pickup.
So Anthony Farah comes in to attempt the extra point, and it's good. 10:04 to go, third quarter. Texas trying to open this game up as the Longhorns take a 27-10 lead.
one of them being a called pass. In the case, McCoy flushed from the pocket and ran and picked up a big first down inside the 5-yard line. A senior night, 20 seniors honored by the Texas Longhorns.
Nick Rose sends it away. And this will be Reginald Davis bringing it out of the end zone. Davis tries to get outside, but great special teams coverage by the Longhorns as Josh Turner comes up with the tackle, but a flag on the play.
And the way things are going, is there any doubt in your mind who this is going to go against? Just the way things have been going with momentum and errors. Kick return usually goes against the people returning it.
During the return, holding number 8 of the return team. Penalty being forced half the distance to the goal. First down.
Sadale Foster, backup running back, picking up the flag.
So Tech backed up at their own 5-yard line. Diamond formation for Baker Mayfield. He'll throw out of his own end zone. Looking. And finally just whizzes it out of play.
Very smart play on his part. He tries to hold it and make a play. He's likely hitting in the end zone. That could have turned into a safety or worse. Good job by Mayfield getting rid of the ball.
And we've seen Texas Tech against Oklahoma, Oklahoma State, Baylor, all games that they managed to score big points. What's the big difference tonight as Mayfield throws again to the sideline and incomplete?
I think the corners from Texas have done a really nice job getting up on them. You remember the Baylor game early in the game, the corners were struggling, right? And then as the game went on, what happened? Those corners really got involved with the receivers and made it difficult for them to run routes and complete passes downfield. Plus, the pass rush from Texas tonight has been fierce.
Third down and 10 at the 5. Mayfield over the middle and caught Amaro with the grab. And it looks like he has a first down. I mean, because you think about it, they lost to Oklahoma. They scored 30 points, losing 38-30. Lost to Oklahoma State. 52-34, they scored 34 more, and then the Baylor, they scored 34, losing 63-34. Right now, though, Texas, you may want to say almost pitching a shutout with only 10 points from Texas Tech. Mayfield. Caught out of bounds, Reginald Davis.
And the defense would say they're just responsible for 3, to your point about pitching, almost pitching a shutout, because 7 came off with a fake punt by Ryan Erksleben and run for a touchdown. But I think the corners and the secondary guys not leaving much room for the receivers. So every pass that's completed, it appears, has been a contested pass.
Second down and 2. To Dale Foster and a flag thrown late.
And don't forget, Texas knows there's not much run threat from Texas Tech. So every play, you're just thinking, sick the quarterback. Go get him.
Remember, Texas has won 7 straight games against Texas Tech in Austin.
Chop left, number 21, offense. Penalty being forced half the distance to the goal. Remains second down.
DeAndre Washington.
Since he's facing a defensive lineman, the only thing I can think is that the defensive lineman was engaged with another blocker. Because if you're blocking straight ahead like that in that zone, you should be able to chop low down there. But if someone is engaged, you can't chop and be a second guy in and do that. It's a good safety rule.
Second and 13. Mayfield over the middle. Incomplete. Marquez, closest Red Raider to the football.
And that one, it looked like he had a shot with Marquez, but he threw to the opposite side of him. Instead of the side towards the middle of the field, he threw to the sideline shoulder of Marquez. That's hard for him to get back over and catch the football. Third down, what has Texas done all night on third down and third and long?
Number 44 watching.
They've heated him up, brought extra guys at Baker Mayfield.
Here's Mayfield in trouble, wants to run. And Mayfield finally dragged down by Dalton Santos. Short of the first down, he picks up 10 on third and 13.
Now look at the pass rush. All these guys are coming at Baker Mayfield. And he finds a lane All right? He's got an exit strategy. He's gone. But look at the athleticism of Dylan Santos, Dalton Santos, number 55. He ends up running him down before the first down marker, and Texas forces another punt.
Fifth punt for Erksleben inside his own 10. No pressure. Shipley at the 30, 40, 50, and finally brought down at the Tech 45. A 50-yard punt and a 27-yard return. Texas with excellent field position. The Longhorns have been running it. Downstairs to Christina Pink for an injury update.
I've got an update on Bruce Jones. Scary moment earlier watching him get taken off the field. Well, Jones has returned to the bench area. He suffered a concussion, but he is in on the bench area, has been all smiles here talking to his teammates, and he will travel back to Lubbock with the team.
That's great news for Texas Tech and for Bruce Jones. Diminutive in size, but Herculean in stature, this young man at 5'7".
Pocket Hercules. Great news that Christina was able to give us that update.
First down and 10 to the 45 for the Longhorns. Johnson, the motion man. They give it straight ahead. Bergeron. And Joe Bergeron, another nice piece of running. Will Smith makes a tackle. And you got to give Mack Brown some credit. A lot of credit. The way the team started, they didn't start the way they wanted to, but they managed to rally 6-1 in conference play. Still with a chance if they get a little help from Oklahoma when the Sooners face Oklahoma State in Stillwater, Bedlam they call it. The Sooners can win that game. And Texas wins out. They still have a chance to share the conference title. Bergeron again. And it's always fun, Charles, to sit down with Coach Mack Brown. It's almost like talking to your dad. He's going to tell you what you don't do right.
Yep.
In a nice way.
He did tell. He's still mad at us about that Oklahoma State game last year when we thought that Bergeron had fumbled the ball before he got in the end zone.
McCoy winds up and incomplete.
Well defended there by Olofolemi.
Johnson, the intended receiver. And we understood Coach Brown's point of view.
Sure.
In front of him, we agreed, but
we disagree, but it's okay.
We agreed when we were in front of him.
Well, we're not crazy. You're almost going to be running stadium steps or something. I mean, yes, sir, Coach.
Yes,
darn
sir.
Right.
He said, sip it,
and
Gus.
And that was it.
That's all she wrote. I'm trying to win a game. Second down.
But you're right, 6-1 in the conference. No one thought that after a 1-2 start.
And Bergeron. That play strung out nicely by Texas Tech. Tackled by Will Smith as he loses 2 yards.
That's a really nice play by Smith, wasn't it? And I loved your description, strung out, which means the defensive line did a very nice job of taking care of the blockers, controlling the line of scrimmage, and allowing the linebacker, Will Smith, to come downhill, as they like to say, to make a tough tackle on Joe Bergeron.
Third down and 12 at the 37 for Texas. McCoy dancing in the pocket, throws on the run, incomplete. Mike Davis, the intended receiver. And that brings up fourth down and long.
Good defensive possession by Texas Tech, forcing the apparent punt from Texas.
So Farrah standing at his own 49. Tanner Jacobson planting his feet on the 10-yard line. This one just popped in the air. Nicely done by Farrah, and fair caught at the 10. But it's been the Texas defense, the story tonight, led by this man, Jackson Jeffcoat.
In the NFL, passed on his pass rushing tips to his son. Told him one of the things you have to do as a pass rusher is pass rush like a pitcher. Change speeds, vary your approach on each time, and don't let them get a type on you.
Here's Mayfield to Amaro. Amaro picks up the first down, still running as he gets to the 30. Michael Thompson with the stop.
How can he not be a Mackey Award finalist for the best tight end in the country?
Is he a tight end?
Really? Yeah, that's what they're trying to claim. Yes, he's a tight end. Anybody watches football? If anybody watches football, how it's played nowadays, there's no question that he is a tight end. Anyone who's 6'5", 260 pounds, is not a wide receiver.
And our Christina Pick spoke to Jace about that issue before the game. Christina.
Well, he took that as a big snub, told me that he is using that as fuel and extra motivation. He said, if they didn't think I should be a finalist for that award, I can only prove them wrong. And that's what he's trying to do here in this game.
Well, he's been doing it all year, Christina, and I can tell you this. I know that the late John Mackey had said he wanted it to be a true tight end award, but I'm not sure John Mackey saw the game changing the way that it has. He's a tight end and should be winning that award.
And here's Eric Ward rounding the corner. Ward has played excellent football this season, folks. He's made some catches that have been mind-blowing.
Tremendous story. Work ethic, captain of the team, married with a son, and I understand another one on the way.
Second down and one. This time it's Davis. Davis still running up the sideline. Davis finally tackled at the Texas 30 by Josh Turner. A 32-yard gain.
Terrific effort by Reginald Davis. Gets a block there from Amaro. Look at Amaro controlling Duke Thomas on the corner. Davis uses the block and then his speed to get downfield. That's what you have to do. You've got to make extra yards after the catch in order to hurt these defenses.
First down at the 30. This time, it's Jordan Davis. Jordan Davis will get down at the Texas 25. Adrian Phillips with the stop. Second down and five. Mayfield running it, and Mayfield gobbled up quickly. Nicely done by Leroy Scott, the junior from Pasadena, Texas.
Because that was a design run all the way. You see Mayfield take about two steps to his right to set up the blocking angles. And then he comes back left. See that? Design run the whole way. And Leroy Scott shoots the gap and makes the play in the backfield.
Third down and 9 yards to go. Mayfield winds up in traffic. Incomplete. Marquez, the intended receiver, but Quandre Diggs knocks it out of his hands.
He really had, they had him sandwiched, didn't they? Looked like two Texas defenders, high and low. Diggs underneath number six, and over the top was Duke Thomas, 21. Almost no way to fit the ball in.
So the Red Raiders going for it on fourth down and eight. Play clock winding down, 3 seconds. Here's Baker Mayfield. And Baker Mayfield sacked again, Cedric Reed. We've called his name a number of times. Seventh sack of the night for the University of Texas. And the Red Raiders turn it over on downs.
And when you're facing this type of pass rush, one thing you have to be as a quarterback is definite. Either I'm definitely going to throw the ball or I'm going to definitely flush and run. But if you get caught betwixt and between, you've got nowhere to go. The athletes are too good at Texas. And they swallowed up Baker Mayfield, who's a good runner, but he's not a dynamic, explosive runner. And without that, no chance on that play. He couldn't decide whether to throw it or run it, and he ended up stalling out. Greg Robinson's defense taking charge again.
Robinson, such an interesting story, how he arrived in Austin to coach this team this season. Here's a handoff to Malcolm Brown. He hits the edge and gets out of bounds. Robinson told us when we met with him yesterday that he was in California coaching a high school team, and all of a sudden he got a call in his driveway and Mack Brown was on the other line.
Yeah, he was actually helping coach a high school team that was being coached by one of his former players at UCLA.
Johnson, nice catch. first down as he gets to midfield.
And then he gets the phone call as he's getting ready to travel to Texas. He had signed a consultant's agreement. He gets a phone call saying from Coach Brown saying, well, you know that consultant's agreement? We want to add to it. We want you to come be the coordinator. And he took it, and you've seen the results from Texas.
Malcolm Brown lowers his shoulder, gets to the 45, gains about six. Trey Porter finally stops him.
He had to have that quick consultation with his wife, Laura, who's been with him every step of the way, and she said, you want to do it, I'm in. And here they are. And now the Texas offense benefiting from his defense, slowing down Texas Tech, the offense back on the march.
Here's a handoff, Brown again, first down.
These runners do not have what you would call long speed. All right, that sprinter speed, 4-4, going to break open huge plays. But they have good vision, they're thick runners, and they break a lot of tackles. And on that last play, Malcolm Brown showed his vision, found the hole on the cutback to the left side when the play was blocked to the right side, and then powered his way for extra yards, breaking tackles into the secondary of Texas Tech.
First down at the 35 for Texas. Malcolm Brown, the pistol back behind Case McCoy. Brown again. When you look back in the history of Texas football, I mean, some of the running backs, very similar in makeup, obviously. Earl Campbell was a big, strong guy. Ricky Williams, not as tall, but wide and stout. Cedric Benson.
Priest Holmes, who was a smaller, compact version, but still broke a lot of tackles. Jamal Charles, much more of a sprinter. Much more of a speed guy. And boy, is he doing well in the NFL.
Second down and six, and Bergeron trying to cut it back. And he goes nowhere. Kerry Hyder playing in Austin with the Lyndon B. Johnson High School.
Really nice play by Hyder. Came into the game with 10 and a half tackles for loss for the season. Add another one to that total. Finishing up the regular season in his career, as you noted, Gus, in his hometown of Austin.
Third down and 10 of the 35. McCoy drops it off. Bergeron with running room. Bergeron dives forward, picks up more than enough of a first down as he gets 23 yards.
Looked like they went zone blitz and Kerry Hyder ended up having to cover the back. A beautiful throw by McCoy.
Bergeron running straight ahead as the Longhorns in that hurry-up offense getting to the line of scrimmage.
How about McCoy's placement of the football right over the top? But see, Hyder, he ends up reeling the play. It wasn't his own blitz per se. He felt the play and went with the running back. But Bergeron was able to beat him in well-thrown football by Case McCoy. Good anticipation by Hyder. He just couldn't keep up with the running back.
Second down at 8 at the 10. Bergeron, the single setback. Swaim in motion. Bergeron. And Bergeron, quick feet.
I know the offensive line is doing a very nice job tonight, but I cannot overemphasize how well number 82, Jeff Swaim, the tight end, is blocking tonight. When you run the ball well and you're playing with a tight end, you can almost bet that he's doing a terrific job as an inline blocker on the line of scrimmage, controlling the point of attack and controlling the edge. Without that, if you're playing with a tight end, you usually don't run the ball well. Jeff Swaim is doing that this evening. Watch him right here. Excellent positioning. And that allows the cutback for Bergeron. See, as he reads it, see, there's a gap now because of the block that Swaim made that allowed him to get upfield to get the yardage he could. Save a holding penalty. Swaim has been tremendous tonight.
And that should be the last play of the third quarter with the score Texas 27, Texas Tech 10. The Longhorns with the football in striking distance. Fox College football will continue after these messages.
Point game at the end of the first quarter. Texas put up 10 more, extended the lead to 20-10 at the half. 7 in the third quarter, taking us to where we are now. Texas up 27-10.
Les Johnson, Charles Davis, Christina Pink with you from the University of Texas. Where the Longhorns have the football, third down and 5 at the Tech 7-yard line. Case McCoy has been very efficient this evening.
What about Jackson Shipley? It's been a while, hasn't it?
McCoy underneath, touchdown. Mike Davis, his second of the night. And a flag on the play for the late hit.
Shipley ran to the outside. Davis came in underneath. McCoy hits Davis, and then Davis gets hit in the end zone. That's what they're discussing now. The flag came out pretty fast. Probably call him for unnecessary roughness or a late hit. Watch Shipley, number 8. He breaks to the outside. Davis cuts in underneath him, wide open. Touchdown. Then he takes the big blow in the end zone from Will Smith, the linebacker. And that's when the flags came out.
After the touchdown, personal foul, number 7, unnecessary roughness defense. That 15-yard penalty being forced on the kickoff. Touchdown.
Cliff Kingsbury, 34 years old, and this will certainly be a season to remember in his first year as a head coach. Started 7-0. But then the schedule got a little rough, and they lost 4 in a row. This could be their 5th if they're unable to figure a way back in this game as we start the fourth quarter with the score 34-10. And a full week of football continues tomorrow on Fox College Football, presented by K Jewelers, with Washington State battling Washington on Fox. Then on Fox Sports 1, FIU squares off against Florida Atlantic, and Oregon State looks to upset 13th-ranked Oregon. Saturday on Fox Sports 1, it's K-State versus Kansas, and Iowa State taking on West Virginia. Then 25th-ranked Notre Dame battling 8th-ranked Stanford on Fox. Fox Sports is your home for college football all week long. And we're going to get on a plane tomorrow morning and head to Palo Alto to call that Notre Dame-Stanford game. What are your thoughts on what we're going to see when the Fighting Irish head to town to take on the Cardinals?
You're going to see a Notre Dame team that's been beat up a little bit, just lost their All-American defensive tackle, Lewis Nix, won't play the rest of the season. But they played really hard down the stretch and had a monster hiccup at Pittsburgh. If they win that game as expected, in a game they should have won, they would be playing for a BCS berth against Stanford. Instead, they're playing for a lot of pride, trying to get a little bit better bowl slot. Stanford, on the other hand, if they win the game, they will still be in the running for consideration for the second team, maybe for the second team in to the BCS, because they still have the Pac-12 championship game left to play.
Tonight, though, the big story, the Texas defense.
The pressure has been there. I know that Tech thought that maybe they weren't going to bring as much pressure as they did, or thought maybe they weren't, but as we were watching this game unfold, when it got to third down, Greg Robinson, the defensive coordinator of Texas, dialed up an aggressive game plan. Extra guys rushing at Baker Mayfield, snugging up tighter on the coverage out on the corner on the perimeter, and bringing 5 and 6 people at Mayfield and making his eyes go from downfield to watching the rush come at him.
Here's Mayfield throwing on first down. And what's been the big difference? I mean, Robinson came in after the second game when Manny Diaz was released and didn't have a lot of time to really look at his defense, even though he was familiar with the personnel.
He had been working a consultant's role, so he knew the personnel of the team, but he hadn't been on the field and didn't know them as individuals. And we'll get back to it after this play.
2nd and 10. Mayfield to the sideline. And incomplete.
Tried to hit him on the back shoulder throw. Good coverage on the top by Duke Thomas. But one of the things that also had to happen was you had a team with a confidence debt because they'd been damaged badly by BYU. And then in the first game for Greg Robinson, Ole Miss running the football. So they had to change what they were doing. Manny Diaz a little more aggressive, a little more all-out pressure. They dialed that back some and shored up the run defense And then that's really helped them overall.
DeAndre Washington, the intended receiver, incomplete. And Texas Tech will have to punt it away.
And that's the big deal. Everyone always tells you, what do we get every time we talk to a defensive coach? Coach, what do you have to do to win this game?
Number nine.
Stop the run.
It's now number 90.
And that's Brandon Jackson, who wears number 9. He'll wear number 90 on the punt coverage because Sean Corker wears number 9 and is also on punt coverage. But they always say stop the run because that breaks down your overall defense. Texas didn't do that against Ole Miss or BYU, and it cost them games.
Kirk Slavin sending it away to Jackson Shipley. Shipley will get a chance from the 30. Shipley, 50 running as he's finally dragged down at the 35 by Will Smith. A 46-yard punt and a 6-yard.
A big one against Alabama this weekend at home. Missouri, if they beat Texas A&M at home, they clinch a spot in the SEC title game against Alabama. What a season Gary Pinkel and the Tigers have had. Gus, you told me this week you think Gary Pinkel might very well be the coach of the year in college football.
I tell you, he's just done such an excellent job in only his second year as a head coach of the SEC coming from the Big 12. They hand it off Joe Bergeron. Bergeron will get back to the line of scrimmage. He knocked backwards. But a lot of SEC folks didn't think that Missouri and Texas A&M would be able to compete as well as they've competed, leaving the Big 12 and going to the SEC, and they sure proved them wrong.
And what was interesting was going into last season, the consensus was Missouri would compete faster than A&M because they were going in the SEC East and they'd had more success in recent years. That flipped last year with the year Texas A&M had, and now Missouri in their second year found their footing after a disappointing first one, and they might very well play for an SEC championship.
Bergeron gets outside, spins, picks up the first down and even more. Will Smith finally brings him down, but Joe Bergeron, he may want to keep Jonathan Gray's number 32 until next season sometime.
As we talked about earlier, he wants to play against Texas Tech, and now he may want to keep number 32. So Jonathan Gray, if you want your jersey back, rehab, rehab, rehab. And we hope he's back really fast. He's wearing that number to honor Jonathan Gray and Jonathan's father, who played running back at Texas Tech.
17 carries, 100 yards for Joe Bergeron. Here's the handoff on the reverse to Johnson with a hole. Johnson still on his feet. And finally, he has it stripped. That's a fumble. And Texas Tech has the football. That's a great job by Tanner Jacobson. He just ripped it right out of his arms.
Now, earlier in this game, I don't think we were on air. You talked to me about guys giving extra effort and reaching late in the play. How much of that should you do or shouldn't you do? Because the coaches always talk about ball security. See the extra effort he's giving, trying to gain extra yardage? And it gave Tech more opportunities to work at stripping the ball out, and that's exactly what they did. Tanner Jacobson just wrenched it from his arms before the play was down. So a big run is nullified with tremendous effort by the preferred walk-on, Tanner Jacobson.
So Texas Tech with the football at their own 21. And a new quarterback, Michael Brewer, in the game for the Red Raiders. Brewer throws on first down and incomplete, intended for Reginald Davis. And Brewer was the man that was tabbed as the starter at the beginning of the season.
Bad back. He hurt his back before camp began, and that set him back in his development. Never played at all this season until the Kansas game when Baker Mayfield hurt his knee. Two series then didn't play again until late in the Baylor game, last game out for Texas Tech.
And a handoff to Kenny Williams, and Williams picks up the first down and more. Williams still running, and he'll get inside Texas territory down at the 42.
Go ahead.
Carrington Bindham with the tackle, a 35-yard gain.
Nifty cut downfield, wasn't it? Good cut as he got about 20 yards into the run to add on extra yardage.
First down. They spotted at the 43. Brewer to Amara. And Amara all the way down to the 15-yard line. Quandre Diggs has to bring down the big tight end.
This is a guy that they thought possibly would start against Baylor, would start tonight.
Williams, and he's roughed up by Dalton Santos.
Didn't. but you know they're going to have almost a month of bowl preparation. Would not surprise me at all to see Michael Brewer starting the bowl game for Texas Tech. They've been trying to find a way to get him ready all year long, as you noted, was the assumed starter going into this season before injury.
He's part of four consecutive state championship teams at Lake Travis High School. All-state is a senior here in Texas. And a timeout called by the Longhorns.
Texas, their first of the half.
Tremendous game.
And he'll watch right now as Texas Tech has the ball at the Texas 12, faced with a second and seven. Michael Brewer in at quarterback for Baker Mayfield. Brewer to throw it. He'll check down. DeAndre Washington and Santos Johnny on the spot makes the tackle for a loss.
Covered a lot of ground, didn't he? For 6'3", 240 pounds, Dalton Santos reads the play and comes from inside out from his linebacker position into the flat to make the tackle.
A loss of one, third down and eight. Brewer feels the pressure and gets out of bounds.
That's another good play by Dalton Santos, because I think Michael Brewer wanted to throw the ball to DeAndre Washington on the scramble. But Santos got into the passing lane, took away that, and then when Brewer decided to run, ran him out over the sideline.
Fourth down and six. Texas Tech going for it at the 11. Here's Brewer over the middle. Amaro, touchdown. Seventh receiving touchdown of the season for junior Jace Amaro.
Tells you how good players like Amaro are, because you're thinking to yourself, he's the guy you've got to cover, right? Red zone, key situation. So like a Tony Gonzalez, you know he's coming, yet he's hard to cover.
And they'll go for two. Brewer in the shotgun. Brewer under pressure and sack. Malcolm Brown. But Texas Tech scores, 11:04 to play, 34-16. Come though, so far for Texas, up 34-16. Amaro with the touchdown catch.
Long way to go. We've seen Texas Tech be explosive during the year.
And this one will be fielded inside the 10 by Marcus Johnson. And Johnson will not get to the 20-yard line. So tonight, Fox Sports Live will bring you all the highlights and analysis of a full day of action in college football, college basketball, the NBA, NFL, and NHL. Fox Sports Live is after the game only on Fox Sports 1.
Got a few highlights they can pull to decide which play is the one tonight that they can pull from this game. Some long passes from Texas.
He's got one problem with that show.
What's that?
Jay's got to shave that mustache. He looks like Freddie Mercury.
Well, he's got to get out of the month of November.
I know, but November can't end fast enough. Malcolm Brown.
You know, Jay's mustache is probably telling him the exact same thing.
Exactly.
Is it not December yet? But this is a big drive here, Gus, because momentum is a tricky thing. And it's trying to decide which sideline it wants to be on right now. It's been with Texas a long time. It might want to go over and visit Cliff Kingsbury for a while, but it hasn't fully committed to it yet. If Texas defense can hold up and get another score, old Mo might tip across there.
Brown, great running. Wow. Look at the leverage. Malcolm Brown, a gain of 14.
Or Mo said, you know something, I'm good right over here. Because look at how he finishes the run. We got Trey Porter coming up to try and put the hit on him. And Porter's an excellent tackler. Brown powers through until he gets some help from Micah Arway, 18. Tanner Jacobson had to get involved a little at the end, too.
Brown with a career high, 144 yards rushing on 27 carries. His previous career high was his freshman year against Oklahoma State when he rushed for 135.
New runner.
Jalen Overstreet, who's the third string quarterback. Malcolm Brown getting low.
And now because of the injuries, a third string running back. There's that career high you talked about, Malcolm Brown, of 144 yards.
Second down and seven at the 38. And they'll pitch it out, Johnson. And Johnson crossing the 40. Justice Nelson brings him down. So when you look at Texas Tech and what's taking place, it's a very odd season for them. They win their first seven, and now it looks like they're going to lose five in a row to end their season. What does Cliff Kingsbury do from here?
Recruit like crazy, first and foremost. They're going to need some bigger bodies, and they're going to make it tough on the spot here in terms of whether it's a first down or not. Let's see. Looks like they got a good left foot spot. Puts him right on at first down, Texas. So recruiting's a primary thing. The second part is you got to get guys who know how to finish out seasons. They've had such struggles here for the last four or five seasons or so in November. I think it's been ingrained in their players. Remember that old character, Schleprock?
Yes.
Walked around with the cloud over his head. Woe is me.
Charlie Brown.
They were 7-0, and they were waiting for the roof to fall in. So they weren't really sure. 7-0, they were, instead of optimism, they were wondering when things would go wrong.
I'm sorry, Charles. Bad luck, Schleprock was the Flintstone.
Thank you.
Previous play is under further review.
And that's what's happened with them. So they've got to go through that process of getting them retrained. When they talk about a new culture, that's what Cliff Kingsbury is trying to put in place, is a new culture for Texas Tech where they can close things out. So once again, the spot comes into play. But that's a really nice spot that Texas got, because they were nowhere near where I saw the left foot go down and give them the first down. They would be short of the first down off of that replay by a considerable amount, frankly.
Mac Brown, so many things could change if Brown doesn't make it out of this season. We spoke to him yesterday, and he feels very confident about his standing as the head coach at Texas. And you wouldn't think that he feels that he's going anywhere.
Yeah.
After further review, the runner was down short of the line to gain. The ball will be placed at the 44.5, fourth down.
Yeah, they missed that spot by at least a full yard. And I would agree with him on that, Gus. Unless things drastically change in the last game of the season, I fully expect him to be back. And now it's going to be fourth down for Texas, and people are wondering, what do you do here? 34-16 lead, 8:39 to go. I think you punt the football. Make them go long field again. They may have just scored on their last drive, but they haven't had a tremendous amount of success all night. I don't know about taking a chance here and giving them more momentum on the plus side of the field. Fourth down, kick it away and go. And their offense is on the field. Here's where you got to be careful if you're Texas Tech, of a long count and try to draw you off sides and then go timeout. See, they'll move a lot of motion here, trying to see if Tech will jump. They're not going to run a play, Gus. Yeah, they're trying to get a cheap one out of Texas Tech and give Tech credit and their defense for holding in and not jumping. And there's Matt Wallerstedt, the defensive coordinator. So now you go out and you punt the football. And as we were talking about Matt, look, they're in contention right now to win the Big 12. Horrible start. Had to fire his defense coordinator, something he doesn't normally do in the middle of the season, fire a coach. Felt he had to make a drastic move. The Oklahoma State game last week was a definite disappointment for them because they got jumped on in their home field. They gave it away really at the end of the first half. 14-10 game, give up two quick ones with 3:28 to go. But I think that the choice is going to be his on whether he chooses to come back or not. I don't think this is in play where they're talking about him actually going. I think this is much more his opportunity and his feeling and belief about whether he can get Texas back on top as they were for so long.
New athletic director.
New athletic director just coming in. Steve Patterson is a Texas guy, knows the culture, knows the climate. And he's going to have a lot of decisions he's got to make in the Texas athletic department. I think barring unbelievable collapse, which we just don't see happening down the stretch, a tough one with Baylor, obviously, I think it's his decision there in football, and the athletic director's attention will be on other sports in the short term.
Coach Brown telling us that his goal to get Texas back in the top five, and he feels that he can do it.
And look at this, still the offense out on the field.
Malcolm Brown, the deep man. Here's a quarterback sneak, and they pick up the first down.
Now that's a heck of a call right there. Because to me, I would have punted it away. Coach Brown feeling a little chesty right now. I know it's a short distance. I would have punted it away and played defense, but he decided, you know something, I want to keep the football, burn some more clock, felt confident what he was getting out of his offensive line and how well they've run tonight. And I get it, but I still would have kicked it away. And you know something, that's why he's wearing that headset.
That's right.
And I'm wearing this headset.
Case McCoy gets a fresh set of downs for Texas. He'll hand it off, now Brown. And he's chopped down. Nice job by Pete Robertson. But the second biggest question surrounding the Texas Longhorns after Mac Brown and his future is who's going to play quarterback for this team next year?
Well, I know that they've recruited. You know, they recruit guys in each and every year. Tyrone Swoops, the backup now, could be the heir apparent. Jalen Overstreet, who we've seen at running back tonight, is another candidate for the job.
David Ash,
if he can get healthy and come back. Going to miss the rest of the season with the concussions they suffered earlier, the clear starter previously.
Here's Overstreet, David Ash suffering those concussions. It's been floated around that his career could be in jeopardy with those concussion-like symptoms.
I know the feeling around the Texas football program is that he'll be back for spring practice, but when you've had concussions like David Ash, you can't take anything for granted about whether a guy will be back. That'll be monitored, and Texas has done a terrific job, I think, of making sure he's not trying to come back too soon.
Third down and 11. Overstreet remains in the game. Redshirt freshman from Tatum, Texas. Here's McCoy. Just floated up and incomplete, intended for Overstreet.
It's a late flag coming in from the side.
There is no foul for offensive pass interference and passes behind the line. Fourth down.
And this time, Texas will punt the football.
But for Mac Brown, the gamble to pick up the first down did more to help them, obviously, than hurt them. They don't get a punt now, but they burned a lot more clock.
So Farrah comes in to punt, standing at the 31. Jordan Davis back deep at his own 10. This ball takes a bounce, may have been touched by a Texas Tech player. Let's see, and it was touched by a Texas Tech player. The Longhorns have the football. Leroy Scott recovering.
I think go ahead. I think
flag on the play.
I think Austin Stewart, it touched him. We'll have to see what the flag is, but anybody watch Monday Night Football last week? Denver Broncos cost him a game, right? Right there comes off of Austin Stewart, and now you see everyone scramble for the football. Now, the universal call to get away from the football is a Peter call. P Peter, get away from the football. Get away from it. And you heard that clearly on Monday night.
The ruling on the field is that the punt was touched by the receiving team and recovered by the kicking team. After the play, personal foul, number 7 of the receiving team. The penalty being forced half the distance to the goal, and it'll be first down, Texas.
Wow. That's Will Smith with a second person, another personal foul, if that stands. But you heard, you saw that. That cost the Denver Broncos a football game. Being able to make that call as a punt returner and get everyone away from the football. Because as we know, football's not round. It doesn't make true bounces, does it? That oblong sphere will go in different ways that you can't anticipate.
Previous play is under further review.
And that one appeared to hop up and hit Austin Stewart on the punt return team for Texas Tech. And now it looks like Texas is in business inside the 5-yard line. An interesting part about this, who was the punt returner in the Broncos game we talked about? A Texas Tech alum named Wes Welker.
Pretty good player.
And he was trying to get guys away. And it just didn't happen. You see Stewart there. That's a close one now. And remember, the call on the field was that it did hit him. So I don't know that we have enough here to say that it definitively did not hit him. And you see Scott's reaction initially. You see how it hits, you know, if he thought it hit Stewart, he didn't dive immediately. It was like he was waiting for the ball to continue to roll and gain additional yardage. Did you notice that about Leroy Scott?
Yeah, I certainly noticed it.
And if that's the case, you know, I'm not saying you could read someone's mind, but remember, they said it hit him, and it's hard to overturn it.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. First down, Texas.
So Texas with 6:11 to go and a 34-16 lead will line up with the football at the 4-yard line.
So I think because they called it on the field, you had to stay with it. So here's Tyrone Swoops. Is that Tyrone Swoops coming in to play quarterback?
Yes, he is in the game.
The people's choice. Hear them chanting Swoops. I was here for the spring game, and he put on a flat-out show and has become a fan favorite, as most backup quarterbacks are early in their career.
And a timeout.
Timeout, Texas. Their third and final of the half.
They didn't have the right personnel in the game, and they took the timeout to avoid a penalty.
Swoops, a freshman from White, Wright, Texas.
Gus, I saw him here for the spring game. Whoa. I mean, took off on some scrambles and trying to bring down 245 pounds of youngster who was running with some fury in his first time out. I'm not sure the playbook was really that well digested, but his athletic ability came to the front, made some throws, some runs, and the crowd walked away buzzing about Tyrone Swoops.
Did he remind you a little bit of a VY?
A bigger VY. I mean, he runs much more, is interesting. Better speed, but more of a power runner like a Tebow was in college. VY, a little more of the elusive type.
At White Wright High School, Swoops passed for 3,850 yards and 41 touchdowns. He rushed the night over for Case McCoy. He rushed for 5,341 yards and 73 more TDs in his career. Ranked the number 2 quarterback in the nation coming out of high school.
Yeah. I'm not sure that Case McCoy is actually done. I think they want to check out some quarterback run game near the goal line here with Tyrone Swoops.
As he hands it off to Overstreet. Overstreet will pick up maybe a yard on the play.
Let's see if they put those young legs to use right here for Swoops in some type of a zone read option, or just him getting out to the perimeter, maybe the run pass option.
Last week against Oklahoma State, he was 3 of 4, threw for 17 yards, 5 carries, 22 yards. And he keeps it, looking to get outside. And he won't. Sam Aguabin getting to him quickly.
Yeah, but Trey Porter made the play, number five, the safety. He's a first force play and made Swoops retreat and go deeper on his cut to the corner. And that allowed Aguabin and the rest of the posse to get to him. Very nicely done by the senior safety, Trey Porter. Another guy playing hurt, broken hand in the Baylor game, and is heavily wrapped.
Third down and goal for young Tyrone Swoops. In for Case McCoy. They'll hand it off, Overstreet. And he will not get in. Nice leg drive at the end of the run. We'll make it fourth down and goal at the one. Let's see what Texas elects to do.
I'd say at this stage, you go for it. Clock ticking down for you. You're in great spot with the clock. Short distance, see if you can pick it up on fourth down. If not, Tech's going to have to go 90-plus yards.
So they're going for it on fourth down and goal. Swoop through the quarterback sneak. No signal yet. And it doesn't look like he got in. Did he get in? And yes, he did.
Let's see how he just stays on top of his guys. Oh, he's clearly in. I mean,
the official's not making a signal.
Took them a long time. They wanted to make sure he had possession of the football, I think, before they raised their arms. But one thing about this group, they get together a lot and make sure of their calls.
Very deliberate, this officiating crew. And the touchdown, the first of the career of Tyrone Swoops. Anthony Farrah in to attempt the extra point. And it's good. 4:22 to play, fourth quarter, 41-16 with under 5 minutes to play. Tyrone Swoop scores the first touchdown of his career, freshman, on a one-yard plunge. Jackson Jeffcoat with three sacks tonight, all coming in the first half, a career-high three sacks.
Nice to see him appear to make it through a season. Last 2 years interrupted by torn pectoral muscles, left and right side.
And don't forget, folks, next Saturday, December 7th, it's the Big Ten Championship on Fox as third-ranked Ohio State takes on 11th-ranked Michigan State to see which team will earn an automatic bid to a BCS bowl game. Our coverage of the Big Ten Championship begins Saturday at 7:30 p.m. Eastern. Only on Fox.
And maybe a little bit more on the line for this one. As you look at Ohio State, 23 straight wins. Michigan State seeking first Rose Bowl since 1988. And what I mean by that is a BCS national championship appearance could be on the line for Ohio State if they win and get a little help above with either Florida State or Alabama.
That's right. Alabama with Auburn this week and potentially Missouri in the SEC championship game. Florida State with Florida and potentially Duke in the ACC title game. And here's Washington with the catch. Got to give a lot of credit to Coach Cutcliffe and Duke and how he's transformed that program.
He's done a phenomenal job bringing a winning attitude in and not letting them settle for just being bowl eligible, but urging them to pursue more. And they have that chance if they beat North Carolina this weekend and Dalton Santos
personal
get a foul here.
55 defense, 15-yard penalty from the end of the run. First down.
And it's the right call because the officials are being consistent here. With the calls they've called for late hits and all, he's clearly out of bounds. Why do you swing him and put him down there? It's done.
17th penalty of the game.
Yeah, Coach Cutcliffe. I played for him in Tennessee. His first job, full-time, tight ends coach, 1982. Look at what he's done since then. Tremendous career.
Brewer to Amaro. And Amaro picks up the first down.
That's a whole lot of man when he catches the football, isn't it?
He's a heavy load. You compared him to young Mike Ditka.
Yeah, I just think that the lucky ones fall off when you try and tackle Jason Amaro.
Six catches, 83 yards for Amaro. As DeAndre Washington runs it, and Washington is knocked backwards by Shaq Davis.
Timeout, Texas Tech, their first of the half. 30 seconds.
So the November struggles for Texas Tech.
All right, 2011-2012, Tommy Tuberville was the head coach of those teams. This is Cliff Kingsbury's first go-round, but he had to get this out of them. He's got to find a way to get that thought process and that feeling of impending doom out of his program. Yes, the schedule's tough on the back end, but it's tough for everyone in the Big 12 on the back end. When you look at every team that contends, it's a gauntlet down the stretch, and they've got to play with the idea that they're going to win and not worry about just losing or finding a way to lose. And that's what he'll be working on going forward.
Second down and 11. Brewer. Nice throw as Eric Ward cradles the football and gets out of bounds. An 8-yard gain. Third down and 3. With the Red Raiders. And the handoff goes to Washington. And DeAndre Washington picks up the first down. Hassan Ridgeway defensively for Texas as the Longhorns get an opportunity to play a lot of their second string guys now. Brewer, and he's sacked. Caleb Blewett, 1.5 sacks tonight for Blewett, who picked up that personal foul penalty early in the game for running into the punter.
That'll help make up for that, won't it?
And a timeout call by Tech.
The injury to Steve Edmund opened the door for Blewett to get more playing time tonight.
Three minutes to play in the fourth. Texas will win this game, and players will get a chance to go home and eat Thanksgiving dinner.
Happily.
Happily. Unable to eat the turkey before the game because the tryptophan makes him sluggish. Matt Brown says, all right, guys, you're going to have to eat something else.
You can have turkey come Friday when you go home with your families.
Coach Brown, very stern face on the Texas sideline. Been a crazy year. Second down and 21. And Ward makes the catch but goes down. Third and 18 at the 36. Texas Tech playing for pride now. Brewer steps up in the pocket and is sacked once again. 11 sacks on the night for the University of Texas. Bryce Cottrell getting to him that time.
Well, he had some help from Peter Jenkins, number 19. So he had a 19 and a 91 getting to the quarterback. Here comes Cottrell, 91, Jenkins, 19 on the front end. Whatever combination of 1 and 9 you wanted, you had it on that play.
And the Red Raiders will punt it away. Instead of going for it on 4th and 25, Erksleben. Off the side of his foot. And it bounces into the end zone for a touchback. It's been a big night, though, for both of the running backs of Texas, most notably Malcolm Brown.
He's become the lead guy since Jonathan Gray's injury. They weren't sure about Joe Bergeron and his ability to handle and take care of the football. So he kept piling it on Malcolm Brown.
And he won't dazzle you with huge runs in the open field, but he'll get you some of the toughest, grittiest, hardest 10, 12-yard runs that you're going to see. And when you pile it all up, it adds up to big numbers. And look at the Texas running game tonight, exactly what they wanted. We said at the beginning of the game, a key to this game was Texas to run it Bevo style. I think that's Bevo style and worth some porterhouse steaks if they don't want turkey for the big offensive line and tight ends.
And Jalen Overstreet running.
Sorry, Bevo, I didn't
mean to. I know I am.
You know, my bad. You know.
It's not Bevo's day, Charles.
But here's the thing. You know that
it's a turkey day, Charles.
See that guy right there? You see Bevo? That's the most protected animal going. All right, he's covered. All right, he's just worried about his brethren. He's like, look, better you than me. All right, I'm good. You guys, you might want to look out.
Second down, 9. Tyrone swoops. And it's Jalen Overstreet again. 53 seconds and counting. Case McCoy, senior, the little brother, and talking to Major yesterday. Those two have really formed a very nice bond because they've been in similar situations.
Yeah, Major Applewhite had to go through the quarterback battle with Chris Sims when he was there. Of course, Case McCoy's been battling with David Ash. Pretty good night tonight. 2 touchdown passes and a touchdown run. Scouting report said his legs weren't a big part of his game, but he used them very effectively this evening for key plays.
Overstreet running the football, and that should be the final play. So the Texas Longhorns on Thanksgiving come up with a huge win, 41-16. They improve 7-1 in Big 12 play, 8-3 overall. Mack Brown has to be pleased with the way his team performed tonight. 41-16, the final. Coming up, Mike Hill and Ryan Field, Fox Sports Live.
Thanks a lot, guys. Happy fans there.